presentation.
Strike up the fans. Labor Day weekend is almost over, but not before we celebrate one of the great Southern college football rivalries. North Carolina Central pulled off a miracle a year ago, coming back from 27 points down to knock off arch rival North Carolina A&T. And it's a loss that still stings the Aggies a year later. There may be some new faces on the field, but this rivalry is just as hot. Hey, we're not playing games. We're making history on NBC Next with the Aggie Eagle Classic. Of North Carolina, A&T are on the march from Greensboro to Raleigh, hoping to knock off their arch rivals from North Carolina Central in the 10th renewal of the Aggie Eagle Classic as we come to you from Carter Finley Stadium in Raleigh, North Carolina. Well, hi, everybody. Great to have you with us with NFL Hall of Famer Lim Barney. I'm Barry Milligan, and Lim, tell you, nothing was better than a win last year. Took overtime, but NCC was able to come up with a big one over the Aggies.
Most assuredly, Barry. You know, this rivalry dates back to 1924 and comes all the way up to the present. And again, last year's victory, that three-point overtime victory, was something they can save up until this point. Now they have to do it again.
That's right. Now for the Aggies, their Blue Death defense is led by Curtis DeLoach, a preseason All-MEAC performer who actually injured his knee in this game last year and wants to have a lot more to say about it in 03.
Most assuredly. You know, Curtis DeLoach is a tremendous defensive back. He's a prototype defensive back at 6'4", 235 pounds. He's a senior. He puts me in the mind of Mel Blunt from the Pittsburgh Steelers. He loves to hit, and he can cover just as well.
Now, a guy he'll be keeping a very close eye on is Lawrence Fuller, who was actually the quarterback for Central a year ago, passed for over 1,000 yards. He is now the full-time tailback.
Tremendous athlete, quarterback last year to tailback this year. He wears number 5, 5'9", 195 pounds. He's a senior. This is no mystery to him. He knows what he has to do.
That's right. All right. You can imagine how much pageantry there has been. 4 days of activities for the Aggie Eagle Classic. And with more on that, let's go downstairs and catch up with Carlos McCormick.
Not even a little rain can keep these Aggies and Eagles away from the hottest ticket on this Labor Day Sunday. Who's going to win this game?
Eagles! Eagle Pop!
Why are you guys out here standing in the rain?
To support my alma mater, North Carolina Central University.
Eagle?
You know?
I think there's somebody out here that may disagree, sir. Why are you out here?
The Aggie Pride.
Why are you out here standing in the rain?
What rain?
Because they won't let anybody in.
Barry Lim, take it away. NBC Sports, catch the game.
All right, Carlos, kickoff is coming up next in the Aggie Eagle Classic on NBC. We are back in Raleigh as North Carolina A&T, Yannick Matthews, set to kick off to North Carolina Central. First-year head coaches on both sides of the field. Rod Broadway, a North Carolina graduate, leading the way for Central. George Small for A&T off the side of his foot. That will go out of bounds and will fall just in front of DeLeon Rayner at the 13-yard line. Flags in the air. That will be an illegal procedure penalty. And we'll see there is referee Steve Smith. Obviously, here, Lim Barney, Central would accept this procedure penalty and be in great field position to open the game.
First play of the ball game, offensively, it sets the tone. Offense has to set the tone here. Again, as we mentioned about last year, coming back with the overtime field goal victory, and they want to get something started here early. So the offense has to set the tone.
We have a legal... We have legal procedure on the kicking team. The ball will be placed on the 35 first down.
Now let's look at a couple of very important players, and oddly enough, both are sophomores, young men in pressure situations.
Absolutely. They are tremendous ball players, and again, we have to see them because they're going to help to be the leaders for their respective squads. We have Glenn for MC, and it's going to be a terrific
first pass is complete. The far side of the field, James Taylor on the receiving end of that. Caught six passes for 165 yards and a touch a year ago. Adrian Warren, the leader of this fast break offense, for lack of a better term, as you look at the Eagles offense, says Rod Broadway, who was an assistant coach to Steve Spurrier at the University of Florida, and given that limb, he said, we want to score as much as we can, as often as we can, any way we can.
So he has at least three ways here, offense, defense, and special teams. So the occurrence of how often he does it is going to be
important for those balls. On the offense, second down.
And obviously a late flag on the play over there.
It was a late hit also. Yeah. One of the offensive linemen tried to get over and throw a block, and it was after the play was dead.
And boy, that is the type of thing that will just make a head coach crazy first year or not when you get those kinds of mental errors.
First play, too.
Again, a four wide out set for Warren. He had Taylor in the slot. Stacked up by the interior of that A&T defense. Number 33, Herbert Dixon, your Mike linebacker, the middle linebacker in there as well. This is a very, very young offensive line. You see there, Jermaine Brantley, a 6'3", 285-pound freshman, may be the biggest surprise for this entire Aggie club.
We have a blitz going now.
Short of the intended receiver on the near side of the field.
Brings up a fourth down.
Dorian Hester was out there, but again, Herbert Dixon in chase of Adrian Warren and George Small, who has been a defensive, brilliant defensive coach throughout his entire career, said, we're coming hard. Their defensive ends are kind of like linebackers. They are very quick, very fast.
Indeed, as we saw then by number 33, Mike linebacker, left linebacker, Herbert Dixon.
Running situation now. Gerald Matkins, who is an outstanding runner, gets one away. Taken behind the Aggies at their own 42-yard line.
This is trouble here.
Down the near side of the field, Curtis DeLoach, who was an all-NEAC preseason performer, as a punt returner, shows just why there. Puts the Aggies in great shape.
There's a tremendous effort here by Curtis DeLoach and breaking back to the right. And we'll perhaps get a chance to see that when we come back from commercial break.
The Aggies will have it when we come back. That's got to get up. And we are back with Len Barney, Barry Milligan with you at the Aggie Eagle Classic here in Raleigh. Central stalls on its first offensive possession. And now the Aggies of North Carolina will, A&T will take over after a terrific punt return by Curtis DeLoach. They're on the 38-yard line of the Eagles. First and 10, Marshall Glenn taking the snap, wants to throw, and the pass complete. That is a not necessarily in keeping with what we expected to see from George Small, but the pass is complete to the flanker Jamal Jones. Good for about a 6-yard gain. Checking this A&T offense, this offensive line, obviously the key to the success. Jen and Barry, the offensive line coach, thinks, you know, he talks about the great commitment that he expects that line to make and set the tone for the entire team, and they have done that. Backs in the eye, and the handoff goes to Frank Patterson. Patterson across the left side, gets a first down, and is inside the 20 of North Carolina Central. Here's the NC Central defense. Again, you talk about line against line, and that's where everything starts. Man, the point of attack is, you know, Rod Broadway told us he feels this defensive line can be as good as any in the CIAA.
They'll need to show it right now. They're in the red zone, and that's a good thing for the Aggies of North Carolina A&T. They're on the march inside at the 19-yard line.
After an 11-yard Patterson gain, first and 10 now, and handoff again. They challenge the left side of that line, and not much doing there for Patterson. Picks up maybe a yard, even if they advance it at all. I believe they'll
spotted for no gain, and that'll be second and 10. Frank Patterson, a 5'11", 200-pound sophomore, played 8 games last year. He can be a dangerous receiver as well. Only carried the ball 21 times, and here's Marshall Penn, we featured. He's also a sophomore. Now a flag and a whistle on the far side of the field. Line judge Richard Maple drops the flag, and we're going to get an offside penalty against the Aggies. Boy, you hate to see that, and you get in the red zone.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You have to keep your thinking caps on at all times.
The Aggies were penalized 16 times for 131 yards in this game a year ago.
Some teams don't gain that much yardage. They were penalized that much, Barry.
That's exactly right. Shotgun set now for Glenn on a second and 15 from the 23. Quick look to the left, comes back right. The pass is incomplete. The receiver, Bud Phillips, wanted a flag on the play. He will not get it. Good defensive coverage by DeLeon Rayner.
DeLeon Rayner, good coverage here. However, he was in a bump and run after the receiver got past him. He has no clue where the ball is. Whips his neck back, get a hand in, a left hand. Just enough to pull it out of the hands of the intended receiver. Brings up a third and about 14.
Boy, you're exactly right, man. He just did get that left hand back and get it in there. DeLeon Rayner from Fayetteville, North Carolina. Third and 15. Glenn once again wants to throw over the middle tip. And that was a very dangerous play. Number 55, Marcus Glasgow, the 6'1 senior, the Mac linebacker, over from his right side to get a hand on that one.
Glasgow did a great job here in coverage. Watch. But again, number 15 had his mouth wide open. Richard Rogers, he was salivating for that ball. Again, great job by the defense to make them go for an attempted field goal of about 40 yards.
The 40-yarder, this is Yannick Matthews, who was 5 for 5 last year. The Aggies really struggled. Bad snap. And they're going to try to get a pass away. And well, Matthews gets it, but that will obviously be far shy of the first down. The holder for A&T, Randall Rankins, had backup quarterback, had problems with a low snap right there.
Here it is. Well, it was a little outside of him, had to stretch for it. He couldn't bring it in. And again, he tries to get up. It's a hot pattern once the ball is not snapped properly. Great defense by the Eagles of North Carolina Central for the turnover on four downs. First down and 10 for the Eagles.
That has to be obviously dejecting for Matthews, who has 45-plus yard range. So the Eagles take over in their own territory, first and 10 at the 28. Hand off to the right side, and not much doing there for Lawrence Fuller, who is stacked up, maybe got back to the line of scrimmage.
Fuller is being welcomed here by the Aggie defense. Again, off-tackle play to the right side. Good defense, good force, and good feel there. Anytime an in-runs occur or sweep, you have to have good force, good feel, good containment. Outstanding play there by the defense on the left side.
They'll actually give him a loss of about a half yard. Officially, we'll call it second and 11. This time, Warren wants to throw and completes the pass over the middle. And an excellent job of picking up some big yards after the catch. Again, James Taylor with his second reception of the game.
He's the eighth receiver. He's a senior. He's got experience. He's 5'11", 180. Good job here in finding open man. Tries to break it back cross game to get the first down. He's shy of the first down, however. I think they're going to bring the chains out to measure it, but it looks like it may be a yard shy. Barry?
9 yards on the game, Lim. Jamar Milton, the 5'11 junior Sam linebacker, comes up with the stop on the play, and indeed they will bring in the change from the far side of the field. I think Rod Broadway wants to see exactly how shy he is of this first down yardage, because, I mean, the difference between a half a yard and 2 is a major difference, and that's less than a yard.
Yes, it is. It's just at about a football length, and the reason for that is that there are designed plays for midfield, short yardage, and goal line plays. So we did very well to ask for a measurement. He knows what's needed now, so he can call the play with regards to the yardage that's needed.
You saw your head coaches there. Rod Broadway for Central, 24 years as an assistant. George Small, there's Rod Broadway.
Yes.
Wants to build a Central program. And really, he talked about he's had a lot of responsibility, and that's kind of natural when you go from the assistant to being the head man.
Yes, it is. It was a commitment. It's a job now.
So it's third and less than a yard. Glenn under center. Patterson, the lone setback. Handoff up the gut, and I'm telling you that he needed about 2 feet.
He got it.
And if he got it, that's about all he got.
He got it. Barely. Tell you what, I couldn't understand that step back when he should be stepping forward. As you look at it again, here's a false step back and then tries to go. Defense had penetrated the line of scrimmage. Good defensive surge there. A little high, but again, good job. Fine job by Adrian Warren to gain the necessary yardage to keep the drive alive.
Well, they do get the first down. The ball will be spotted at the 38-yard line, the initial first down of the game for Central. There is Warren. Again, a West Virginia transfer, and they talked about, Rod Broadway talked about him being a very fast learner. 15 days he spent in the spring. Sean Williams, the backup, was actually injured in the spring. So Adrian Warren got all the snaps, and he really made the most of his time as the number one guy and earned a starting job on the option. Warren with the keeper across the right side of the line, picks up 5, maybe 6 yards on the play. Pretty good-looking run.
Absolutely. Great-looking run with the man in motion to offset the middle linebacker that has to vacate. Get a chance to watch it again. Here it is, a little motion. Fakes it out to the up-back, Lawrence Fuller. But again, good yardage on his own as the offensive line had opened up a nice gaping hole there. Picked up 6, bring up 2nd down and 12.
Ricky Lewis on the stop, the defensive end. 3 receivers to the far side of the field, and turning around a little bit too late on that one was James Taylor as the pass. If he turns around and comes back to that, it's a big completion. A little bit of miscommunication perhaps between Warren and Taylor.
It may have been a ill-advised pattern that was run by number 9, James Taylor, but again, it's a tough pass to throw, throwing across your body, going the opposite way of your hand. He's a right hand who tried to throw left, running left. So, again, incompleted forward pass brings up a 3rd down and 4.
Trying to convert on a 3rd down situation once again. Central, the pass complete. Far side of the field. That is James Hopkins, who comes up with the catch. This is a nice-looking drive here from Adrian Warren, back-to-back 3rd down conversions.
James Hopkins is a junior, 6'4", 210 from Fayetteville, Westover High School. Good job here, a little high. Had the presence of mind to feel the defenders in the area. Covered the ball up so he wouldn't fumble.
So 1st down, the ball just into Aggie territory. The snap is handled. Warren comes up with it, though, and able to pick up about 3 yards. That's it. You got 3 out of nothing right there.
That's making something out of nothing. Absolutely correct. Ball a little low. Wasn't fell cleanly by Adrian. Here it is. He's looking upfield instead of watching the ball. Again, his speed and his quickness allowed him to get outside. And again, having enough power to muscle ahead for about 3.5 yards.
Yeah, give him 4 officially on the play. Intercepted and coming the other way. I believe that's Joey Lance. It is. The 6'1", 210-pound bandit linebacker got his hands in the air, picked that one off, and the Aggies are in business once again deep in Central territory.
Here's the replay again. He just turns and looks and just standing right there in the gap. Number 58, 6'1", 210-pound senior Joey Lance. And he has some speed to get the ball upfield.
Now we see Lance again.
Another angle.
At the press conference for the Aggie Eagle Classic, there was a little repartee. play between Lance and head coach Rod Broadway for Central. Lance is actually a graduate student in graphic design. Coach Broadway said, son, you need to concentrate on your studies. That's enough football for you. But Lance obviously had some football right there. But it looks like this one is coming back. And
yes, big penalty.
Central is going to keep possession of the ball.
After change of possession, we have a legal block in the back. 10-yard penalty against the Aggies. First down, Aggies.
Aggies ball. Aggies keep the ball.
And that obviously is huge in terms of field position because that is counted off from the spot of the foul.
Absolutely.
So the Aggies will keep possession, but at their own territory at the 33 instead of deep in the Eagles' territory.
Offense thought they was going to retain the ball. It does go over to the Aggies.
Right.
So as a result, a big penalty. Instead of starting down in the red zone of the defense, they're starting off 33-yard line of their own territory.
So a good-looking drive results in a turnover for Central, and here come the Aggies. A handoff. Nice cutback for Patterson, who gets out to the 40-yard line. A gain of about 7 yards on the play for Frank Patterson.
Richard Rogers coming up with the stop from his strong safety position in the secondary, holding on for dear life. As we'll have a chance to see it again here from the eye formation, good cut. He runs to daylight. And there you see number 15 wrapping up for dear life is Richard Rogers, a junior, 6'1", 214, fine stop.
I tell you, Lim, juniors Constant, Kareem Sanders, Patrick Jordan, the right side of that line, did a great job of sealing things off this time. Oh, they missed tackles, and Patterson is all alone down the sideline. He gets into Eagles territory down to the 37-yard line, but there is another flag on play.
Just in the last series, I talked about when an end run or a sweep occurs, you need force, feel, and containment. We didn't see it from this one. It was already gone. But they had great force. They had a great feel. They had a great containment, but nobody made the tackle.
This one is coming back to them. Penalties are killing the Aggies here in the first quarter. Already three huge flags that have gone against North Carolina A&T. Here's Steve Smith.
Holding on the offense. I can read lips.
And you see there just exasperation in the body language for George Small.
This may be the penalty here. Block in the back, even though it wasn't that successful. You can't block in the back. You can't push in the back. You got to get up front, get in front of your man, put some leather on, not from the back.
So instead of a huge gain and a first down, it'll be second and five. Again, that spot as a result from the yardage being assessed after the spot of the foul. Backs in the eye. Oh, man. With the delayed handoff and Frank Patterson wrapped up. That'll be a loss of at least a yard, maybe two. Lynn Barney, what about the keys to success in this game for the Aggies and Eagles?
Well, one thing about the North Carolina Central Eagles here, WBIH, it's an acronym meaning watch ball in hands. During practice all last week, Coach talked about the ineffectiveness of his receivers catching the ball. You got to watch the ball in your hand if you're going to be an effective receiver. We'll get on out of the next.
Four wide receiver set this time for the Aggies. As Glenn in the shotgun wants to throw, plenty of time.
Again, we just talked about what Central needed to do to win this game. WBIH, we'll get a chance to see it again. He short arms it, takes his eye just over to the watch. Takes his eye off the ball. He's got a WBIH. Watch ball in hands. Here it is from another angle from behind it. Watch his head. Head is drifting away right as the ball is getting to him. You can't run with it until you catch it. You can't catch it until you watch it in your hands. WBIH.
Jalon Rayner back to receive the punt. Yannick Matthews, he got it away. End over end. Bounces Jones at the 30, inside the 25, and that will fall dead at the 23-yard line. But we have a penalty flag sitting on the ground at the 25-yard line of the Aggies.
Roughing the punter, no doubt.
And it's the personal foul variety against NC Central. So we see right now the penalties offset because this is a huge one. The Aggies are going to keep the ball.
Yes, they are, I tell you. All you have to do is think about it. Once you go in, even on a punt block, it's a design play. If the ball is away, dive off to the side of the punter so that you don't make an incidental contact with him to penalize your team. You had the ball first and 10. So now you give it back to the offense. First and 10 for them in your territory.
Ball now on the central 49-yard line. 6 minutes.
Get a chance to look at it here. Here he comes up the middle. Boom, right there. Incidental contact, but again, it draws a 15-yard penalty, which is flagrant, and it awards the ball back to the offense, first down and 10 at your 49-yard line.
You know, Lim, just a bad angle. The angle was into the punter as opposed to being across him.
Absolutely.
And his momentum carried him right into the legs of Yannick Matthews, first and 10 in central territory for the Aggies. Off to Patterson, and he's got running room across the right side, giving 7, maybe 8 yards, down to about the 42.
Maybe a 7-yard Stanford. Good job. Good interior blocking in that offensive right side of the line for the Aggies. They blew the Eagles back. We'll get a chance to see it again. A lot of popping. You can hear it up here. Good trap blocking. Look at the hole. I could run down there and get through it myself, Barry. But again, 7 yards, second down and 3.
Richard Rodgers on the stop, and I'll tell you, you're looking pretty good. I believe you could get down there.
I'm only kidding you, Barry.
Backs in the eye this time for Marshall Glenn. Hand off once again. Goes to Patterson, and he gets a block on the left side of the line. The ball's on the field, and it looks like Eagles that Central has recovered. Some positive yardage after the initial contact. There's a wrestling match going on. All arms are pointing, and now the one that counts points the way of the Eagles. That fumble recovered by number 24, Lewis George, the free safety.
Good job. A lot of popping. You can hear it from here. You can hear another popping. Watch. Boom. There's the ball. Stripped off. Lewis comes up with it. Here it is again. Initial contact. Number 23 putting that helmet right on that Rydell. Boom. Ball comes out. Great opportunistic turnover for the Eagles, who were being grabbed upon.
And Lim, I think it was his younger brother, Andre George, who made the hit that caused the fumble.
Slide the family stone to say it's a family affair.
It was right there, and right now it's Eagles football. First and 10 at their own 33. The pitch comes to the near side. Excellent sidestep. And some positive yardage there for Lawrence Fuller.
Yes, it did. I held my breath when he made the move.
I mean, you can hear the fans actually say, ooh.
Absolutely.
That was an impressive move. Gain of 5 on the play. So, boy, a couple of very, very big breaks here as the Aggies got one on the roughing the punter penalty, and now big turnover. One turnover apiece now for these teams. They're giving 4 on the play officially. Second down and 6, we'll call it. 2 wide receivers to the far side of the field. Warren wants to throw.
I don't understand that play at all.
That's the pass away and way out of bounds. He was being harassed over there by Doug Okaracha, the 6'2", 230-pound senior defensive end. He plays that Aggie end position for Alonzo Lee. As I was talking about, these ends for the Aggies, this Blue Death defense, they're really like University of Miami type ends, 250 to 260 pounds. They have great speed, great quickness, and are able to play the aggressive style that Coach George Small wants. Big third down play now for the Eagles. Long looking to throw, no time. He comes near side, across midfield, and he picks up.
Number 1, Adrian Warren on the keeper.
poise for the sophomore transfer from West Virginia. Adrian Warren with a 15-yard gain puts the Eagles in Aggie territory.
Great job here. Wasn't too impetuous here, but he looked downfield. Everybody was covered. Saw a lane open on the right side and was wise enough to get out of bounds. Don't take an unnecessary hit if you don't have to. Had somebody breathing down his neck, too.
That was Herbert Dixon, the middle linebacker. Uh-oh. Little movement now. Big Reggie Monroe, the 6'2", 311-pound senior tackle. I tell you, you get 311 started, and it's hard to get Uncle Mo stopped.
That's like a dump truck moving down the hill. And once you get started, it's hard to stop.
Dead ball, false start on the offense, repeat first down.
That fella got a little windy there with that call, didn't he?
Yeah, I believe you're exactly right. Steve Smith needs a breather. We are at the Aggie Eagle Classic, where there are a lot of people short of breath. There's a lot of excitement here with NFL Hall of Famer Lynn Barney. I'm Barry Milligan. We finally got Carlos McCormick out of the tailgating area and into the stadium. We'll check in with C-Mac in just a moment as the pitch goes to the far side of the field and a pickup of about 3, maybe 4 yards for Fuller. The stop on the play. Shamar Milton, that Sam Backer with excellent pursuit.
Tremendous pursuit, but again, defensively, they played it right on the right side to the defense. They had a good force, good field, good containment. As a result, they didn't pick up the first down. They picked up about 3.5 yards. We'll call it second and about 12.
Once again, though, in Aggie territory on the option. The pass comes near side, and it is complete to James Taylor.
Yes,
Taylor's third reception of the game, a short gain, maybe 2-3 yards on the play, perhaps. It's going to be a third and long situation for Warren and his Eagles.
Good play design, but again, great reaction by the defense on the left side. Immediately upon the reception of the ball, they converge, which is taught. It's a drill and a skill that's taught in practice.
No huddle offense, third down and 8. As Warren brings the Eagles right to the line. 4 wide out set.
The
pass goes to the far side.
I thought it would be a touchdown. He slowed up a little bit, I guess just to keep from going out of bounds. Here it is. Great angle by number 7 coming over in pursuit to make the touchdown saving tackle, Charles Hopper. Fine job. Back to live action.
First and goal. Play Herbert Dixon with the stop. Check it again.
Here it is again. Good toss out to him. Again, good job here. I couldn't see the number. It looked like 33 came up with the ball. I'm trying to see who stripped it. Eddie.
Well, I'll tell you.
Eddie Rebell.
5 fumbles last year. They lost 3 of them. This is a huge one. We told
Herbert Dixon came up with the fumble recovery.
We got Carlos McCormick back in the stadium. Let's find him on the sidelines. Carlos.
Hey, guys, what's going on? So far, so good for both of these coaches. And a big reason why, they have identical backgrounds. They're both from small towns in North Carolina. They both have at least 20 years of coaching experience. But the thing that really matters to me is talking to the players about their coaching, the real father figure. And we talked to both coaches on Friday.
It's not about me. This thing is much bigger than Coach Broadway. This thing's about North Carolina Central University and this football program and trying to build a football program basically from scratch.
It was hard for me to understand it at first when I came here in 75. It was like the game. I mean, you could lose other games, but you did not lose this football game.
George Small. A former All-American lineman coming back to his roots, so to speak, at North Carolina A&T on a first down play. Patterson stutter stepping on the far side of the field. picks up a couple. He picked up 14 on the first down play deep in Aggie territory. That got him out of a big hole. So with the clock running, 3:19, no score here. First quarter in the Aggie Eagle Classic. But boy, North Carolina Central has had a great opportunity go by the wayside.
Absolutely. Closest that any team has been all day, and they nullifies it with a fumble. Herbert Dixon comes up with the fumble recovery. Opportunistic for it. Aggies on the move.
And off goes to Fuller again. And he is stood up on the far side of the field. Richard Rogers makes the hit, stands him up before he's able to pick up first down yardage, but he will get about five on the play. It'll be third and about two. And Lim, you know, ironically, this is a very similar situation to what we had a year ago in terms of the weather. Very wet football. They had thunderstorms last year. We had thunderstorms today. Central fumbled the ball five times last year, lost three of those. And boy, that one could have really cost them it could have cost them a lead here in the first quarter.
Pretty good. Richard Rogers coming up defensively to make the stop. Short yardage midfield goal line. It's 31. Big play here for the offense.
Double tight end set. Backs in the eye. The handoff. Over the left side goes Patterson. That'll be J.J. Thompson on the carry, the big fullback. And he comes up with first down yardage.
Grenier comes up with the stop. After the 3-yard gain, needed 1 yard, he comes up with the necessary yardage to keep the ball alive. 2 minutes remaining here.
Actually, let's give props to Carl Scriven, who was actually third team on the depth chart. But Carl Scriven comes up with the first down, and the Aggies convert. Glenn wants to pass. Plenty of time. They set up a screen. It's in and out of the hands of Scriven. Not able to come up with it on the far side of the field, so that will fall incomplete. And you just hold your breath a little bit. Anytime the receiver has that ball pop in the air, as you know, there are DBs everywhere.
Good setup here, even though Scriven didn't have any blockers. He had two there. Watch. Turning his head. Did WBIH. You have to watch the ball in your hand in order to run with it. You have to catch it first. Good job there by the offense. Again, no good because it didn't catch.
A minute 54 to go in the first quarter. Still no score in the Aggie Eagle Classic. There you see your total yardage right now. Central with the bigger number, but the bigger mistake. And that's the difference in this one in terms of this game being tied. We'll take a break and come back to Raleigh for the 10th renewal of the Aggie Eagle Classic. No score with a minute 54 to go in the first. Great to have you back with us here for the Aggie Eagle Classic on NBC. And as we keep telling you, we're not just playing games, we're making history here on NBC Sports. And this game, obviously, a big part of Southern college football history, this rivalry between North Carolina Central and North Carolina A&T. Frank Patterson, 9 carries, 57 yards for the A&T offense, but Nisho Hollingsworth will get a shot right now, and that group will get a shot. These respective bands coming up at halftime for A&T, the blue and gold marching machine, the marching sound machine for NC Central. And I tell you, make it a quick run to the refrigerator before the halftime shows, because you don't want to miss a minute of it.
We just saw our logo on NBC, major broadcast cable network, working their way 35 games this year.
Marshall Glenn,
37.
All the way at quarterback. Nisho Hollingsworth with a block. The pass comes near side complete. For a very short gain. I'm not even sure he made a gain at all. The pass was complete to Jamal Jones, the flanker, the 6-foot senior. 41 catches for just under 500 yards a year ago. There's some Aggie pride.
There's a play worth seeing again if we had that replay. Jonathan Sherrill, terrific job coming up from this cornerback position to stop this and make the tackle for just about a half a yard loss.
That's right. And we'll call it third and 11. The ball spotted at the Aggies 36-yard line. Glenn out of the shotgun wants to throw. They go to the out the down, and it's overthrown out of the reach on the far side of the field. Kenny Perry, the 6'5 junior, gave it the little out route and then went down, tried to get the safeties to bite on that one, but the pass overthrown. That'll bring up fourth down and a punting situation for A&T.
Grenier and Sherrill in double coverage there. Covered it pretty good. A cover two. Short and long. Brings up a fourth down and punting situation.
Yannick Matthews set to punt it away. Lamont Rayner, the junior out of Fayetteville, deep to receive. Nice tight spiral, a low kick, however. Rayner going to field that ball at his own 24. Gets up near the 30, and he is stopped right there on the pursuit. For A&T, number 58 on the initial hit, Joey Lance, the linebacker. Shallop, North Carolina, makes the stop. So about 6 yards on the return. It'll be first and 10 Central from their own 30-yard line with 52 ticks remaining here in the first period. There's Coach George Smalls. We told you this guy has been a defensive genius back in 95. His Kentucky State team was number one in the nation in total defense, had the number one pass efficiency defensive club in 97. As I mentioned as well, first team All-MEAC back in 78 for his same Aggies. Pass complete by Sean Williams, who has checked in now, the 6-foot junior quarterback, and it is complete to Nathaniel Fitch. There is Williams out of Fayetteville, North Carolina. He did a little bit of everything last year. 456 all-purpose yards, played quarterback, played a little wide receiver, was a kick returner. As I mentioned, he was injured, missed 10 days back in the spring with a thumb injury, and that's really when Adrian Warren came on so strong and earned that starting berth. And here is Williams, handoff to Fuller on a little trap play. Fuller's going to pick up a couple. It'll be third and about 3, maybe 4 yards if the Eagles are going to convert. But with that, we have come to the end of the first quarter here in the Aggie Eagle Classic. So we will take a break. George Small hurling out some instructions. Rod Broadway hoping his team can get another third down conversion as we make our way to quarter number two in the 10th annual Aggie Eagle Classic. At the end of one, still no score from Raleigh.
I'm Kim Fields, and you're watching NBC, your family's urban network.
CIAA scores for you. Edward Waters College loses to St. Augustine 43-16. Shaw beats Livingstone 44-34. Lane beats Virginia Union 12-6. Carson Newman beats Winston-Salem 21-14. And Benedict beats Elizabeth City State 18-6. West Virginia State loses to Bowie State 27-7. Now back to Raleigh.
George Small, the first-year head coach at North Carolina A&T, was a defensive line coach and defensive coordinator at Hampton. George Small, so glad to be back. And I ask him, Lim Barney, as you know, what's it just like for you being back in your home area? You were an All-American at A&T. He said, well, more than anything, I just like being back because I get mom's home cooking.
That's better. I can honestly say I hope I hold it together. I'm probably going to be more focused on the football game than myself, because my philosophy is it's not about me, it's about A&T.
And what an emotional moment it had to be for him walking out on this field.
Most assuredly, most assuredly. We don't talk about mom's cooking.
Also, a lot of people can cook, but can't nobody cook like mine.
Absolutely. I put myself in that big boat, too. All right. Third down. A long three. And Rich is on. And Williams is sacked. Big play
Ricky
by
Lewis.
Darrell Hamilton, the backup defensive end. Ricky Lewis in there as well. The Michigan State transfer, Darrell Hamilton, as he comes on, wow, makes the initial hit. I'm telling you.
An explosive move there by number 94.
That's
Ricky Lewis, 6'3", 245.
Yep. Ricky Lewis, 13 tackles, 4 tackles for loss last year. Given one so far here in 03. Coming situation for Central. That will take an Aggie bounce, and that is down. A couple of yards shy of the 50-yard line. Pretty short kick right there, about 22 yards on the punt. So excellent field position once again for A&T.
Indeed. Short punt. Pretty good height, but didn't turn over. Took a bounce. Serendipitous bounce there for the Aggies of North Carolina A&T.
Gerald Mack is just a sophomore, but he is, preseason at least, considered one of the better punters in the CIAA.
Well, Coach Rich, you'll start showing that.
Exactly. Marshall Glenn under center, backs in the eye. And off to Patterson. It's a block on the perimeter, turns the corner, picks up 10, maybe 12, gets it into Central territory, down to near the 40-yard line.
Leland Paul there on the stop. Number 11, junior defensive back, 6'4", 207. Again, speed kills. And just a tremendous burst of speed. An explosive run there by number 21, Frank Peterson, to get it to the outside before being touched. 11 yards down the field. First and 10, ball's at the 41-yard line.
I tell you, give Carl Scriven a lot of credit, too. He made the block on the perimeter there, the kick-out block that allowed Patterson to turn the corner. First and 10. Play action. And he gets away from one man, avoids another, looking downfield. Almost intercepted and hit the ground. Yes, it did. That ball incomplete, but a nice defensive play. Number 24, Lewis George, down there on coverage.
I'm getting excited up here. I thought it was an interception. Come on, Lewis. You got to watch the ball in your hands as well. Great close on the pass. You get a chance to see terrific speed.
Well, he gets
one missed tackle. Two missed tackles. Here he goes. There's the second one again. He stands up, rifles it. Watch Lewis close. Great job. Everything but the ball. Come on, Louis, what's up?
That was great closing speed. So incomplete on the pass. We'll make it second and 10. Wide receivers to the near field on the call. Patterson to the hole.
Finally on the stop. This guy's tired. He's looking for the sideline. He's looking for water. He's making people miss. A 31-yard scamper, a 30-yard scamper. Great play. Draw. Here it is. Penetrates the line. One miss. Two miss. Back. Ooh. Look out. Look at Frank's run. Another missed tackle. 30-yard scamper before he's brought down.
First and 10 at the 11-yard line. Double tight end set. The handoff to Patterson. That's a block. And it's a 5-touchdown Aggie.
Who thought he was tied under the field?
The first score of the Aggie Eagle Classic comes with 13:03 to go in the first half. And the touchdown is scored by Frank Patterson.
Watch this again. Again, I thought he was winded. Good blocking at the point of attack. Stood to in their blocks. Double team in blocks. He goes in. Nearly untouched by human hand.
The extra point is good. And with 13:03 to go, second quarter, the Aggies have struck first. Our score, A&T 7, North Carolina Central, nothing. We'll be back.
Come on, get on with your life.
Frank Patterson, 12 carries, 108 yards. The last A&T drive capped off with an 11-yard touchdown run. Now let's go down to Carlos McCormick, who's alongside a man who's very familiar with that Aggie pride.
That's right, Barry. The Aggies are very happy. They just scored, and of course they got a big whopping check, $100,000, and a big part of that is this guy beside me, Jim Lanier. Why did you guys feel it was important to donate this money?
Because our athletic department does not operate on state funds. It operates on student fees and also individual donations. So we have a national Aggie club with 6 chapters, and we contributed $100,000 toward athletic scholarships and the use of the athletic department to do as they need in order to support the athletic program here from A&T.
Thanks a lot, Jim. Barry, 7-0 A&T. Up to you guys.
Carlos, thanks. That is Ryan Craig on the kickoff return, and he now has a number 32 tattooed on his chest. Big stick right there by Charles Parham, a reserve defensive back out of Richmond, Virginia, who has made his presence felt in a big way here.
Everybody stayed in their lanes, and again, barely getting it over the 20-yard line. Great pick coverage by the Aggies of North Carolina A&T.
That is still Sean Williams in at quarterback for the Eagles, trying to make something happen, throwing back across the green. And it looked like that ball a little bit wet, perhaps slipped out of the hands of Williams, intended for James Hopkins, well shy of his intended receiver.
Good pressure up front. Good pursuit from the right side defensively by the Aggie defensive line. Applying pressure. Good force keeping him inside the pocket, making him throw erratically. Major broadcasting cable network at your service.
Second and 10 for Williams. Looking with a floater. It's picked off! And coming the other way is Maurice Weaver, who gets it inside the 15-yard line. The Aggies will have it. First and 10 at the Central 12-yard line.
Sophomore Ricky Maurice Weaver, I mean. Picking it out of the air. Underthrown ball. Here it is. Good job. Good coverage. Ball didn't have enough air underneath it. Good job moving it back upfield. Big number 75, Pondley, bounces him out. Big Richard Gray. Again, great job by number 19, Maurice Weaver.
Mo Weaver got the start today and has had a lot of playing time because of a hip injury to James McCoy. And he made the most of his playing time right there with a big interception. Another Central turnover. A handoff and short yardage on first down for Carl Scriven. Maybe got it to the 10-yard line. Picked up a couple. It'll be second and 8.
I know Weaver hopes he doesn't play anymore the way he's playing out there. Fine job, fine coverage in the secondary. Really almost like a throwaway pass. He didn't put enough oomph on it. Underthrown, good coverage again by Weaver, taking it back into the red zone.
Brett Phillips, your lone wideout to the far side of the field. Double tight end set, backs in the eye. Glenn under center. On the option, Glenn with a keeper. He is stood up at the line of scrimmage, but able to spin out of that hole and pick up about 3 big yards on the play.
Shamar Robinson on the stop, linebacker on the right side. A senior, 600, 245. Get a chance to watch it again from the end zone. Here he is. Good force, good feel. Good job. Tried to strip. Good techniques that are taught by your defensive coordinators. He's trying to wrestle with it. Strip it away from it. Third and goal.
Third down, 4 yards to go. They can get a first down, but they have to get almost to the 3-yard line. 3 wide receiver set. Draw play. Well read. Excellent pursuit on the play. That is number 2, Red Brown, who comes up the senior linebacker to make the stop. Shot a gap right there.
Jamar Neely, good job.
Nobody fooled on the the draw play. So the Aggies will try to get three out of this one. After the turnover, we have already seen one bad snap, or one mishandled, I should say. It wasn't necessarily that bad a snap, but we will see if Randall Rankins is able to field this one. He does. The kick is in the air. Both kick, but it is good. Yannick Matthews with his first field goal of the year gives the Aggies of NCAA a 10-0 lead. That's where we stand when we come back. We are back as a very concerned Rod Broadway and his NC Central Eagles trail. George Small and North Carolina A&T 10-0, and Lynn Barney. Turnovers have resulted in all the Aggies points.
Certainly has. Here's a timely interception here thrown right to the linebacker who was in great position. Here's a strip fumble brought on by the hard defense and good pursuit of the Aggies. And here was the third turnover. Fine interception by Weaver, taking it back up in the red zone. But again, it only produced 3 points. Good defensive stance there by the Eagles of North Carolina Central.
Well, that's a good point. This score could be worse. The Eagles could be in a hole similar to that in which they were able to climb out of a year ago, but at least it is just 10-0 right now.
Could be 24-0 right now.
Yeah.
Three touchdowns and a field goal.
So Matthews, who just converted the 26-yard field goal, will kick off. Roger Craig, DeLon Rayner, back deep to receive for Central. At the 7-yard line, it's Ryan Craig across the 20, 25. He's at the 30. Gets out to about the 32-yard line before the stop is made, and it's number 23 on the stop for the Aggies, Eddie Ravenel.
Yes.
Lawrence Fuller, we talked about him being such a quality athlete. He is our central student athlete of the game, a poli sci major with a 3.4 GPA. No wonder Broadway was so impressed with how smart that young man is.
Remember this name. He could represent you as a lawyer one day.
I'm telling you. Under center, Adrian Warren back in there. They try a little dive handoff after the fake to the perimeter, but nothing doing there. Jermaine Brantley, Osita Olaribe,
Jamar Milton put a hat on a hat.
I'm telling you.
Man on man. Amado, Amado, Afuchi, Afuchi.
How do you like that?
Give it to him again.
He got a couple on the play. Four wide receivers set. Fuller is the lone setback, and the handoff across, given to the flanker. Flags fly everywhere. Nathaniel Fitch took the handoff.
Might be a flip. Might be the preliminary indication.
We shall see. That will negate what would have been about a 7-yard gain. Our referee Steve Smith coming over to talk to the line judge, Richard Maple.
Holding offense. It goes by.
So that will bring it back. We saw sort of a penalty-heavy first period. It has not been that way here in the second, but this is a holding call that will drive North Carolina Central back deep into their own territory. That will come from the spot of the foul at the 29-yard line. So we'll march it back 10 yards. They'll spot it at the 19.
10-yard penalty, repeat, second down.
Good chance to see it from the right side here. You can't see it now. I thought maybe it was a clip down at the bottom of the screen by a receiver, but again, preliminary indication holding by an offensive line.
Reggie Minot, the big right tackle over there, might have been guilty of that one. Out into the flats, the pass intended for Brian Debnam, incomplete. So that'll bring up third and 18.
I can't Barry, I can't understand that play. It's a tight end, and it's under the line of scrimmage pass. He's not that fast. He's not that quick. You got to get the ball downfield. You got to advance the ball. Put it in the air.
Once again, Lawrence Fuller will be the lone setback. Adrian Warren will work from the shotgun for wide receiver set for the Eagles. Warren changing the play at the line of scrimmage. Now Fuller in motion to the near side. Five wide receivers on the play to pass. Caught by Fuller. That will be good for a first down. All the way out to the central 44-yard line.
Tremendous catch there. Great concentration. Saw it all the way in his hands. Knew he was going to get hit. Watch number 25 coming up from the secondary. James McCoy. Boom. Good job. Good catch from the political science maker. Yeah. Feel the action. Watch your popcorn. You might knock them out of your hands.
Needed 18, and he got 20.
Boom.
Shamar Milton, who delivered for that Aggie Blue Death defense. That is a huge loss.
This is called a double knockout, offensive knockout. Boom on number 93. And then Shamar Milton coming over, knocking out the quarterback. Adrian Warren. Good plays.
Wow.
A loss of about 14 yards.
Call it 12 officially, so it'll be second down and 22 for Warren. Looking downfield, flushed out of the pocket, and he's sacked again.
You've got three linemen just standing around watching the parade. Coming up with this stop.
Osita Olarabe, the big
That's exactly who it is.
Comes up with his first tackle for loss of the season.
Good job. Look, you see one, two, three, four. You see five men just standing around watching the parade. You got to put your nose on somebody's face. Put it in somebody's numbers. Go, Barry. I'm sorry.
Third down and a soft sand wedge right here. 24 yards needed for a first down. One. Pocket again, looking downfield, throws, and it's almost picked off. Playing center field back there, Charles Harper comes up just short of this one, so another very, very strong sequence for this A&T defense, and it'll be a punting situation for Central.
Tremendous defensive effort there for the Aggies of North Carolina A&T. A tumultuous series for the Eagles of North Carolina Central. Could have been another interception.
Back to receive for A&T, Curtis Deloach, the all-MEAC performer. They want to probably try and keep it away from him. He's as dangerous as anybody in the league.
Well, he did a good job then. I doubt if he got 20 yards on this punt.
Not a good punt again. Gerald Matthews has really had some problems punting today. Coming up at the half, the sounds of the game. Well, that. At Billy Hayes, who has changed schools in this rivalry, so to speak. Former coach, now athletic director at NC Central. And also, of course, first half stats and highlights as well.
That last punt covered all of 10 yards, Barry.
Ouch. That's just a killer. Now the Aggies will take over first and 10 in Central territory at the 40-yard line.
Momentum is certainly on the side of the Aggies here in this first half.
Oh, big time. This second quarter has been all A&T.
Indeed.
Backs in the eye. The pass from Glenn complete to Jamal Jones, who has had a fine game here in the first half. Looks like they're going to mark it right at the 30-yard line, and that is enough for a first down. Give him 10.
10 on Jason Jowers' tackle there after the first down had been gained. Good tackle. And Raynor, good stop defensively. First down yardage was picked up, however. First and 10 at the 30.
As you see, we're inside 7.5 minutes to go here in the second period. 10-0, Aggies lead. A&T knocking on the door again. That pass just a bit overthrown and just out of the reach.
Kenneth Perry.
Of number 80, Kenny Perry.
if we get a chance to see it again, and I'm glad we do, watch this. Watch him give up his body to get this. And had the defensive back, good coverage there also by number 25, Lewis George. George is not watching what he's doing in that close. That's a touchdown by number 80, Kenneth Perry. Great effort.
Yeah, Jonathan Sherrill, that a timing play all the way. Jonathan Sherrill had his back to the play the entire way. That could have been very dangerous. A draw play now. Obviously, Marshall Glenn saw something, saw a seam there. He thought he could sneak over the left side of his big center, Junior Costin's hips. Junior Costin, 6'3", 280 pounds, and he is an outstanding center.
I believe the middle linebacker cheated out just a little to the outside. Great heads-up play by the signal caller now, Marshall Glenn. Slipped in there for a sneak of 7 yards, third down and three.
You know, that's a big difference because A&T this year with offensive coordinator Daryl McNeil, they're allowing Glenn to make some audibles, change the play at the line of scrimmage. That is something that A&T's quarterbacks absolutely were not allowed to do a year ago. They got the play call from the sidelines. That's the play they ran.
What a difference a year makes, huh?
That's right. A change in staff as well. That will be, I believe, just inches shy of a first down. They'll call for a measurement, stop the clock, call for a measurement. You know, we talked about the changing of allegiances, if you will. Linwood Ferguson, now the offensive coordinator for NC Central, was with A&T a year ago. It's a new staff for A&T. Daryl McNeil, they're bringing him to the line of scrimmage. Fourth down and inches with the Aggies just outside the 20.
Fresh set of dimes, clock top, 5 minutes, 47 seconds remaining in this, the second quarter. 5 minutes, 47 seconds before the half. Convincing lead right now, 10-0. About to add to it if they could maintain possession. What a job for Patterson.
Yep, Patterson. Over the century mark, 112 yards already in this game and a touch. Big Patrick Jordan, 6'5", 295-pound right tackle, getting up a little bit slowly. But I tell you, if Daryl McNeil and George Small thought the O-line was the secret to the success of the Aggies offense this year, I like their chances.
They can bet on it.
This O-line has played very well this afternoon. On play action.
Across the middle, Eric Arnett for the score, untouched. Big play on that run.
Matthews will try and tack on the point after. The hold is good. The kick is good as well. Hey, give some props to Big John Cato. The tackle who had pulled and given his quarterback, Marshall Glenn, plenty of time to throw a perfect strike to Arnett. And with that, we'll take a break. 5:20 to go, first half. And the Aggies have jumped out now to a 17-0 lead. Well, after a scoreless first quarter, the Aggies of NCAA&T have erupted for 17 second quarter points, and the Aggie pride is alive. And indeed, we have seen a MEAC attack here on NBC today. The Aggies and George Small, first-year head coach, have completely controlled the second period of play.
Unquestionably. Great defensive play, great offensive play, and terrific special team play. He's got everything working on all cylinders.
Yannick Matthews, who just tacked on that point after, set to kick off. Deep to receive for Central. Ryan Craig, DeLon Rayner. 3 yards deep in the end zone. Rayner will take a knee, and wisely so, because the Aggies had their ears pinned back, baby, and they were down there in coverage big time.
Indeed.
I tell you, again, more props for the young man who caught the touchdown, Eric Arnett, the 6'4 junior out of Lumberton, North Carolina. That is the first catch for a touchdown for his career.
I know he kept the ball. Can they keep the ball in the count?
I hope so.
They have to pay for it. They have to not stay in their dorm for one night.
And there he is. It'll be a fun trip back to Greensboro for Eric Arnett. And right now, it looks like it may be. But, I mean, keep in mind, 17-0 is not safe. We know that because a year ago, it was 27-0. And Central came storming back to take the overtime win. We'll see what the Eagles can do now. First and 10 from their own 20. Near side, Warren with the keeper. Diving over the left tackle, picks up 3, maybe 4 yards.
Number one, Adrian Warren.
Marcus Lewis.
So we're getting another look now at Warren. He played the first couple of series. Sean Williams, the junior, replaced him for a couple of series, was ineffective. So now Warren is back. Going in motion is James Taylor. Rolling right is Warren. Looks downfield. He's got his man out of bounds at the 38-yard line. Nathaniel Fitch with the catch.
Takes the ball across the 35.
First down.
37-yard line.
That will be a very nice first down. And again, the Eagles will come. No huddle. They will stop play momentarily to spot the ball and move to James.
Check with me at the line of scrimmage. He's calling audible plays here. He has been for the last quarter. In fact, this entire quarter, they need to design plays that are moving downfield.
Fuller lined up in the slot, and he makes the catch, and he loses about 7 on the play. That is great pursuit from those linebackers. Shamar Milton, we talked about that. Those defensive ends are so quick. The linebackers are so quick. Shamar Milton comes up from his Sam spot and makes a great play.
Again, just as I was getting it out of my mouth, you need to advance that ball downfield. He throws another lateral pass, and they all over it like a cheap suit from Sears.
It'll be 2nd and 18 on the play. Or after the loss, rather. Quarterback draw, and again, the blocking broke down right up front. Adrian Warren, I believe, wanted to pass that ball, but he was absolutely harassed immediately.
Watch the defensive line. Defensive line. Looks like it's just porous. The defensive line is just pouring through the offensive line.
You're right, Lim. Okoraja, Olarabe, Brantley, Lewis, those guys are doing a tremendous job up front. It's now 3rd and 20, flag slide.
Defensive line got their ears pinned back. You talk about pinned back. They was on the move then.
That'll be a procedure penalty, so that will back the Eagles up 5 more and bring up a 3rd and 25. Central's going the wrong direction.
Offensive line saw that the defense had their ears pinned back, too. That's why they jumped prematurely.
Darrell Hamilton in there as well.
Coach Broadway was looking for something a little more sharper than this out of his offensive line. He's going to have to regroup at halftime.
Rod Broadway obviously very, very concerned right now. His team trailing 17-0. 3rd down. And a very, very tough spot. Warren down in the pocket again, and he's brought down. There's the freshman we've been bragging about, Jermaine Brantley. 6'5", 285 pounds, as George Small told me. He's been the biggest surprise I've had this year.
He's 6'5". He's a big kid. He's got a lot of... Look at it. Look at it. Boom. Didn't give up. Stayed with the pursuit. Came up with the stop. 6'5", 285 pounds. Freshman out of Savannah, GA.
Boy, they'll have a lot to look forward to with that young man playing along that D-line.
Brendan, too, by the intended block man from A&T. Again, this is going to work.
First foul, roughing the kicker, automatic first down.
Well, and that's the huge one. You know, there are two varieties you will either run into or the personal foul variety, and this is the big one.
Yes.
So, George Small obviously unhappy about that as his special teams unit gives up a huge first down. The ball all the way out now to the 41-yard line, first and 10 for Central.
The player who ran into the punt, the punter, he was not only sneaky, but he was shy too, because we never saw a thunder, man.
He got that back leg and sent Watkins reeling.
And we don't know who it is. They don't call numbers in the region.
2:32 to go now for North Carolina Central to try to get some points on the board. The snap is fumbled, and Fuller comes up with it.
Charles Futrell is now the quarterback.
Charles Futrell, the freshman, 6'6", 182-pounder out of Fayetteville, North Carolina.
Almost a disaster. It was
almost a disaster, and I'm just a little surprised in a hurry-up offense-type situation here, two-minute-style offense. They're going to bring the freshman in, give him a shot. That pass over the middle is caught. Nathaniel Fitch. Hey, why not give the freshman a shot?
Well, the first snap was actually fumbled, but coming up alerted to make his reception was Lawrence Fuller. Here is Futrell again.
Now the clock's running now. They try to get a new lineman in there, and Central does. Coming in, Sam Funches along the line, and that pass incomplete. Thrown behind the intended receiver.
Maurice Glenn.
Incomplete to Glenn, and that will give Central plenty of time here to get new personnel. They will not go for the first down. It's fourth down and a long yard. The ball just shy of midfield. They're going to kick it away here and give the Aggies about a minute and 20 or so seconds to work with before the first half ends. Kicks it away. Pretty good distance on this one, but again, it takes an Aggies bounce. Now goes sideways, and it's touchdown at the 11-yard line.
There you go.
So the Aggies will take over 89 yards away from the end zone with a minute 24 left before the first half. And George Small, once again, as we told you, he's back as the leader of this A&T club and knows after what happened 1 year ago that no lead is safe, even though his team is up 17.
It was a tremendous letdown among the Aggie fans, the way that they entered the football game and the way that Central was able to come back. And, you know, I'm addressing that even further as the game approaches, as far as it's not so much what they're doing as what we are doing.
Frank Patterson with the handoff. There's Coach Small in the offensive unit. Darryl McNeil, the coordinator, will keep things a little conservative right here with the Aggies so deep in their own territory nearing the end of the half.
Until that run, Frank Patterson had rushed 14 times, over 112 yards with an 8.1 average. What a job.
He has had a tremendous first half. Picked up four there. It's second and six. 50 seconds and counting until halftime. Two tight ends, backs in the eye. Patterson again. This time on the left side. Runs into his big left tackle, John Cato, and goes down after a gain of maybe a couple. Jamar Robinson with the stop for Central. We will see if they get the ball spotted. In fact, the Aggies wouldn't have to run a play if they choose not to.
They should show some mercy, but I don't think they are. No, they're not.
They will come to the line. This will be the final play of the first half. They won't even snap it.
That's clemency.
Yep, and that's a good thing to do on a wet field, a wet ball. You don't want to risk a fumble deep in your own territory. It has been a very dominating second quarter for North Carolina A&T, a 17-point. second quarter for the Aggies, and that's the difference as we have reached the half. 17-0 A&T over North Carolina Central. And now let's go to Carlos McCormick with Coach Small.
Hey, Coach, you guys are up 17-0. What do you say to keep the team motivated for second half?
We got motivated now.
Talk a little bit about your defense, though. They really are stepping up today.
Aggressive. Trying to find the football.
Thanks a lot, Coach. Barry, back up to you. It's a great game down here.
Carlos, thank you very much. George Small almost has lost his voice already. They'll have to maybe get him a little spray at the half. Aggie Pride has stepped up and then some here in the Aggie Eagle Classic. Our halftime show is coming up next at the half. Our score, A&T 17 and Central nothing. We are back at Carter-Finley Stadium in Raleigh. We're at the half of our Aggie Eagle Classic to score A&T 17 and North Carolina Central nothing. And now it's time for the halftime show and starting things off under the direction of Kenneth G. Rockets, the A&T blue and gold marching machine. The dancers are the golden delights. Drum major, Old Steel. Enjoy this one.
Thank you.
comes the blue and gold marching machine from North Carolina A&T and the Golden Delights Dancers. Stay with us. Plenty more halftime coming ahead with the marching sound machine from North Carolina Central.
Thank you.
Nonsense Dances. Well, as we watch this North Carolina Central group, the new athletic director, Billy Hayes, a former A&T head coach, it's been quite a year of transition for this administrator at Central.
As you look at Bill Hayes, the winningest coach in North Carolina A&T history. This is one of the few times that they have failed in the red zone.
5-yard penalty, repeat second down.
Bill Hayes not happy with that call, and mistakes like that is what really has hurt.
It was just one of those kind of years when we didn't get the breaks and nothing went our way, and we were young and trying to gel as a coaching staff and as a team, and some folk didn't understand and had gotten a little bit spoiled by some of the success we had in the past, and wasn't patient enough to wait on us to put it together totally again, which we would have done, and just kind of panicked. That doesn't really bother me anymore. Of course, it did in the beginning. But when my players call me back, and kids always call me at home and tell me what I did, what I meant to them, and how much I nurtured them, and what kind of impact that it had on their life, I always wanted to guide and direct the lives of young men because it was fair. It was something that was direct. It was something honest. You know, you got out of it what you put in it. You couldn't cheat it. And I used to always tell my players, don't cheat football. If you cheat, it'll break your heart.
People who know, they say you can't go home again. But if you ask me, I'm happy to be home again.
It's been really special, especially coming back home. You know, I was raised up about three blocks from here. I used to walk right through this path to come to college here at NCCU. You know, I had polio as a kid, and to come from that situation and hone my skills to the point that I could play well in college, high school and college, and then become a leader of young men, you know, is something truly special to me.
Coach Hayes, the athletic director for North Carolina Central University.
Good morning.
I'd stay on this side of the fence nowadays.
Well, I got a big one. This is bigger than anything I've ever tried to do in my life, and that's guide and direct this program and take it to another level.
You know, you look at it that way. Preseason.
Interacting with all these makes me have a full day. You know, when you're coaching football, you do some work in the mornings, and then paperwork in the mornings, and then you get a chance to go out to the field and breathe a sigh of relief. When you're an athletics director, you work all day long and half the night trying to keep programs together, and I'm learning how to do it, and it's getting better at it every day and enjoying every minute of it.
All right. You're right. Let's go get them, man.
All right.
Okay.
Bill Hayes won a Black College National Championship at A&T back in 99. Now, the head man at the athletic department at NC Central. We'll be back with first half stats and highlights right after this. We are back at the Aggie Eagle Classic. 17-0 MCA&T over NC Central here at the half with Lynn Barney. I'm Barry Milligan, and Lynn, all defense for A&T that set the tone in the first half.
Defense indeed has set the tone. Normally it's the offense, but here for the Aggies, it's been the defense. Big play here by number 58, Joey Lance, picking up an interception and take it down into the scoring zone. And here, good defense here, good force, good field, a strip. The ball is turned over by number 33, Herbert Dixon, and again, number 43, Charmon Milton, making a big play. And here's number 19, Maurice Weaver, with an interception timely.
And our first half stats, as we see, rushing yards just tremendous. Remember, A&T was the number 7 rushing team in the MEAC last year. They wanted to turn it around. That's a great way to do it.
Absolutely. It certainly is. You can look at the differential there in the yardage, 134 to 26. Passing yards, 93 to 31. But the biggest difference is there on that right column, 17 to zip.
Exactly. All right. Central came back from a 27-0 deficit a year ago. Let's see if Rob Broadway thinks they can do it again. He is down on the field with our Carlos McCormick.
Coach Broadway, what did you tell the guys there in halftime?
I tell them we need to play better. Eliminate the turnovers. We gave them 4 extra possessions in the first half because of turnovers. We can't do that with a good, against a good opponent like AMJ. We got to protect the ball more, and we got to move the ball on offense. I thought the defense hung in there pretty good and played pretty solid, but the offense not helping us right now. We had 2 bad punts that put us in bad field position. So if we can correct those things, we'll have a chance.
What's the morale of the team? Did you give them a speech about last year and what happened?
We're not concerned with last year. We're concerned with this year. But they know we got 30 more minutes. We decided before the game that we were going to play for 60 minutes, and we have 30 more to go.
Thanks a lot, Coach.
All right, great job, Carlos. We appreciate it. And, you know, Rod Broadway, Lim, was telling me he really wanted and expected to steal at least one game this year because of his special teams play. And it really has let him down a bit here in the first half.
It certainly has. The first 30 minutes, it was a letdown. And, again, as Coach Broadway said, there are 30 minutes remaining, the third and the fourth quarter, and it's on the way here in the third.
Jamal Molden kicking off for Central. Deep to receive. Brandon Trusty, and he fielded that ball over his shoulder at the 3-yard line, got it all the way out past the 25. That was an excellent return on a line drive kickoff. So the Aggies will have decent field position here as they begin the first possession of the second half.
Defensively for the Eagles, they have to come up with some timely plays, some fumbles as well as interceptions and some stops. It was a runaway show here in the first half with the running of number 21, Frank Pitts, averaging 8.1 yards per carry for well over 115 yards. Tremendous first half for Frank Patterson.
Indeed, and as you saw the numbers from Marshall Glenn, not great. The one touchdown to the young man, Eric Arnett, but he was awfully effective when he needed to be. And he starts the second half here out of the shotgun. Pitch left. And the defense in high pursuit. The break the tackles. Hit Patterson. He's one block away. He's across the 40, the 45, and finally run out of bounds on the far side of the field. But a big run. Frank Patterson making something happen. And he did a lot of that on his own.
He did it all on his own. I tell you, he was stopped defensively. They had played a pretty good cut back here. There he is. He's blocked off. Great nifty move to his right. Keeps his legs turning. Picks up a fine block here. Turns it upfield. He's making people miss. He's got what's called avoidability and escapability. Terrific job. First down and 10. Ball is at the 46-yard line.
Finally run out of bounds by Richard Rogers. A 22-yard run. And, hey, credit the quarterback. That was Marshall Glenn that made the big block on the corner. Then sprung it. Here's Patterson again. Into central territory. Down to the 35, the 33-yard line. Back-to-back huge runs for the sophomore, Frank Patterson.
Here's 24 air yards. Just when you think he's tired after an empty run, he comes back and murders you. Here it is again. Good job here. Logged up home. He bounces it out to the right. Head, shoulders upfield. He's moving, maneuvering. Good job of sidestepping would-be tacklers. A 24-yard pickup. First down and 10.
And Lim, one thing that impressed me so much, and now Central's going to take a timeout here.
They're
trying to figure out. Damon Fringers, the defensive coordinator, obviously not happy with what's going on here. One thing that impressed me so much in that last sequence, after the stutter stepping, you look up. Who's there downfield? It's John Cato, the big left tackle. It's Terry Jones, Junius Costin. That offensive line that has been challenged by Daryl McNeil and offensive line coach Shannon Berry are doing a tremendous job today. That this season, NBC Sports premieres a special 5-part series, NBC Biographies, profile some of America's most famous black athletes, Tiger Woods, Michael Jordan, the Williams sisters, Muhammad Ali, and Kobe. Mark your calendars. Watch this new and dynamic series, NBC Sports Biographies. It premieres October 22nd.
I can't wait to see that.
And George Small would like to see a little more of what's been going on right now. Back-to-back huge runs. Frank Patterson, 43 yards on consecutive rushes from scrimmage.
secondary spot, defensive back Lewis George with the recovery.
Well, after looking like an All-American, Frank Patterson coughs it up there. I believe it might have been the Mac linebacker, Marcus Glasgow, that came in there from the backside. Knocked that ball away. Here come the Eagles, first and 10 from their own 27.
Call now, 1-800-251-9601.
So, man, hey!
There is the pride of Charlotte, North Carolina. Senior linebacker Joey Lance, two interceptions today, the last of which has given his Aggies a 23-0 lead. And remember, this is the guy, he's a graduate student in graphic design. He has designed some perfect defensive plays today.
Indeed he has, Barry. I tell you what. If he continues to play this season like he's playing this game today, I could see him in a training camp next year. This is Weaver's interception. This is one of three interceptions. Here is Joey Lance's interception. This is the last one that he ran in for a touchdown, and he had one. It looked like it was a twin play. Great plays by the defense. Three turnovers by way of interception. Great coverage in the secondary.
And four total turnovers today so far for Central. 33 yards on the return for the score for Joey Lance, who has fired up. And he certainly has every reason to be. 23-0 Aggies with 14:13 left in the third period. And A&T kicking off. From the seven, it's Maurice Glenn. Out to the 25-yard line, he's hit hard by a host of Aggies, but Central desperately in need of some kind of offense. Right here, Jerome Myers, sophomore linebacker out of Fayetteville, North Carolina, makes the stop. First and 10 Central from their own 26. This time, Sean Williams comes out of the huddle, and he will quarterback the Eagles.
Shotgun formation.
Three wide receiver set, inside handoff, goes to Lawrence Fuller. He is cut back, and he is sworn. Herbert Dixon holds his ground at that middle linebacker spot, makes the initial hit.
Great Mike play by number 33, Herbert Dixon, sophomore linebacker at 6'1", 215. He's playing like a monster back today.
I tell you, this Blue Death defense gave up a lot of yards, a lot of points a year ago, Lim Barney, but right now we're seeing one trend continue. A&T was plus 20 in terms of turnover margin against its opponents last year. One of the best numbers in all of college football. Plus 15 in terms of interceptions, plus 5 in terms of fumbles. Now, if the offense continues to do its job the way we've seen today, this could be a monster turnaround from the losing season that A&T had a year ago.
Most assuredly. You know, the giveaway-takeaway ratio, some people say it doesn't have an effect on the ball game, but it's certainly been a big plus today in this ball game.
17 of the 23 points have come directly off Central turnovers. Third down. We'll call it a long two. Double tight end set. This time, Williams is under center. Fuller is the the lone setback. He gets the handoff. He is hit right at the 35-yard line. He will be very, very close to the yardage he needed for the first down. He is popped up there by Darrell Hamilton, the big defensive end, a transfer from Michigan State.
I'm not pessimistic by no means, but I don't believe he got it. Look at the crowd of yellow jerseys from the Aggie A&T piling on. Wasn't even close enough to Memphis. It brings up fourth down, a punching situation.
You're exactly right, Lim. He had to get across the 35. Did not do it. Matkins has had a very tough day. This guy was expected to be one of the top punters in the CIAA. This is a low spiral, but it does take the Central Mountain. That should be, well, it easily could have been, I believe, a flag thrown on the near sideline. None flies, however, as Curtis Deloach makes the short return, gets the ball out across the 30-yard line. They'll spot it very near the 32, and that's where the Aggies will take over.
There's the defensive back, 6'4". 235, a big kid.
Just great size.
Yes, indeed.
Here's our offense for the day. Frank Patterson breaks one up the middle for a touchdown on play action. Here's Eric Garnett with his first touchdown reception of his career. And you just saw the linebacker Joey Lance celebrating his final Aggie Eagle Classic and doing so in fine form. As we come the other way, this is Misho Hollingsworth with his first carry of the day. A trap across the left side of the line. Again, John Cato, Kerry Jones opening up big holes over there along with center Junius Costas.
Great job continued by the offensive lineman up front, making gaping holes for the running back, whether it's number 21, Frank Patterson, are now number 8, Misho Hollingsworth.
Chris Gates is in there as well right now at left guard. A 6'4", 330-pound sophomore. Gain of 8, 2nd and 2. The pass complete to the near side to Brandon Trusty. Just a sophomore. How many underclassmen have we called today? I know we've talked about Lance, and he's had a tremendous day, but look at that young man. Marshall Plant, just a sophomore. Trusty, a sophomore. There is a lot to look forward to at A&T.
Indeed, there's a plethora of underclassmen that are still on the roster, that are still growing and maturing, and it's good to have that type of competition in many of the skilled positions.
And we talked about that offensive line as well, Lim. There is only one senior, Kareem Sanders, the only senior on the two deep depth chart along that offensive line. Again, it's Misho Hollingsworth who gets the call and tries to weave his way through the middle of the line. Picks up about 3. Gets the ball into Central territory, however.
You want to know about the beat? Where's the beat?
Oh, there's big time Cato. 295.
Good drive. Look at him. Good high position there. Driving his man back. Great job by that offensive interior lineman. The front 5.
They'll give him 3 on the play. Make it 2nd and 7. The ball just across the 49. Hollingsworth spins again. He might have gotten back to the line of scrimmage. Maybe a yard gain.
That overhead projection shot you just saw was provided by our outback glimpse. I'm only kidding, folks. I'm only kidding.
Good pursuit coming off the corner by Sir Zizi, a 5'9 freshman corner, getting a little PT here this afternoon in this Aggie Eagle Classic. 3rd down, 6 yards to go. They need to get almost to the 42-yard line. This time, Glenn will work from the shotgun. Hollingsworth is setting up the screen to the near side. Hollingsworth gets
the ball to the 40. They got to the 40.
25, 20, 15. He's out of bounds. The 11-yard line, a beautiful screen that got the first down and much more. It'll be first down, Aggies. 38 yards on the completion.
Needed about 5. Look at Misho Hollingsworth. Good job here. Avoids one would-be tackler. Got a blocker up
front. It'll be first down.
Here's another look at it. Great job here. He needs to change the ball over to his left hand. He gave the stiff arm with his right arm, but again, he gets out of bounds. Right at the 10, we're going to call it first and goal, Barry.
Junius Costin with a great block. Chris Gates downfield with a nice block before Richard Rodgers ran him out of bounds. The pitch to Hollinger this time, nothing doing.
Lost him about 3 yards.
Lewis George up to finish off the play from his free safety position. Shamar Robinson in there as well. Yeah, he's going to lose significant yardage there.
For the first time today, one of the very few times today, was a good force, good feel, and good containment on the left side defensively for the Eagles of North Carolina Central. They've got to show some mettle here.
Boy, this Eagle defense has been on the field an awfully long time, too.
Yes, they have.
They'll call it a loss of four. Second and goal from the 14. Glenn out of the shotgun, over the middle, the ball.
Caught
is thrown behind the receiver, but what great hands by Kenny Perry.
It was deflected. Good presence of mind, good eye-hand coordination, very good body movement. He was persistent, and he comes up with a tip ball. Here it is, tip there. Look at that. Look at the body control. What a job.
That is a tremendous grab, a 10-yard gain. And I tell you, he had DeLon Rayner coming hard, too. Third and goal from the four.
6'5", contorting that body like that to still come up with the presence of mind and gets that ball.
He worked the backside of the eye. Scriven with the lead block. Hollingsworth knocked down. First hit at the four. Lean forward. Got a yard. It'll be fourth down from the three.
Fourth and goal. Let's see if they'll go for the field goal or try and put it in the end zone. You don't see any special team personnel changing up.
You're exactly right, Lynn. They're going to try to punch this one in. George Small, his offensive coordinator, Gerald Nielsen. We're going, Aggies. Double tight end set, backs in the eye. Lynn with the handoff to Hollingsworth over the middle. He's fighting for the goal line, but stopped short. Stopped just short of the goal line.
What a stand there by the Eagles.
Lewis George comes out of the bottom of that pile.
First and 10.
They'll turn it over on downs.
Great job, but tremendous effort here by number 8, Michelle Hollingsworth. Good job there by number 47.
Oh, he got
coming up
hot
defensively, yes. Shamar Robinson. Good stick, a big hit. He'll get an arrow for his headgear on Monday.
You better believe it. Robinson made the initial hit. Stood him up, spun him around. George up from the safety spot to finish things off. But, all right, that's the good news. The bad news is you're 99 yards from Pater.
And you get a safety.
It's a safety.
I'm not a problem, but I called it.
Watch the surge. The line surge.
There he is.
Oh.
Number 43 shooting the gap. Shamar Milton, linebacker 5'11", 235 a junior.
Marcus Lewis with a great job as well. A safety for the Aggies, and they lead it 25-0.
Call 800-651-5024.
Well, it's 25-0 after the safety. One of the biggest names for NC Central we have not called today because Sheldon Connor entered out of the game, and he is on the sidelines now.
That's right, Barry. Sheldon Connor, preseason All-American and All-CIAA. How tough is it watching this game today?
I worked hard all summer. It was very tough.
Are you all right? I understand on Thursday you were in a car accident. Is everything all right with you?
Yeah, I'm fine. I'll be back Saturday. But I just had stitches in my head. I just got them out right before the game. So I'm good, yeah.
I saw you over on the sideline motivating the players. What exactly were you saying to them?
Just telling them to keep playing. No matter what goes on, keep playing. If anything bad happens, keep playing.
Thanks a lot, Sheldon. Good luck the rest of the way. Back up to you guys, Barry.
Carlos, thank you so much. Sheldon Connor, 11th in the top 20, rather, last year in Division II. The tackles for loss. It was just a tremendous loss having him at the game, as now the Aggies coming the other way on the punt return. Curtis Deloach all the way out near midfield, and that's where the Aggies offense will take over. A September 8th, enjoy the last of the summer celebrations with Evander Holyfield and Real Deal Records. This one-hour special features the sounds of recording artist Regina and his Alex. Watch fireworks with Evander. That's Monday, September 8th at 9 p.m. right here on NBC.
Barry, we certainly wish Godspeed with Sheldon Connor. It could have been worse than that accident.
Thank God
it was just as minor as it was. And as you just mentioned, he'll be back next Saturday.
He was actually the passenger in a vehicle that rolled over. You're exactly.
Look out!
Esho Hollingsworth!
Look out!
Touchback! Out across the 30. Down to very near the 28-yard line. And another Aggies first down.
Watch it, pull your popcorn if you're sitting on the couch. Here it is. Esho Hollingsworth giving a leg, taking a leg, keeping those knees pumping and turning it upfield for valuable yardage inside the 30. We'll call it the 27. First down and 10. Aggies on the move.
26 yards on the game. What a 1-2 punch we have seen today with Frank Patterson and Esho Hollingsworth. Aggies driving, 6:40 and counting, third quarter. Hollingsworth again.
Gets look out!
Up front. He breaks through. And finally, is dragged down by Andre George. A shoestring tackle by Andre George is the only thing that separated Esho Hollingsworth from the end zone.
Good blocking at the point of attack. Trap blocking. Good nifty moving by the running back, Esho Hollingsworth. And you call it a shoestring tackle. He tackled him with his fingernail. Good job here making people miss and continuing upfield, gaining valuable yardage. Another first down and 10.
This time the ball rests at the 17. Up by 25 and looking for more. Backs in the eye. Hollingsworth going to be hit this time behind the line of scrimmage, and he goes down. Anthony Harris, the 6'3 junior, the first guy to break through there and hit him.
Big Tony Harris doing what he does best, getting upfield. We haven't called his name that much today, but a great stop there by the big man who weighs 265 pounds out of Burlington, North Carolina. A 4-yard loss.
You know, Lim, we talked about this. The Aggies 4-8 a year ago, and as we had said, if you look at the halftime, they were leading and would have won 7 of those games if they hold a halftime lead. This is a North Carolina A&T team. Tremendous physical condition, and it looks like a completely different team. They stayed in Greensboro. A lot of these guys all summer long went through a tremendous off-season weight training program, and I think we're seeing the fruits of that today.
Absolutely. And one thing, there's a code in the National Football League, Barry. If you control a line of scrimmage, you're going to win most ball games. We look today, both offensively and defensively, the Aggies of North Carolina A&T has controlled both offense and defensive line.
They have owned the battle of the trenches. It's third and 15 from the 22-yard line. Glenn now will call. Instead, there will be flags thrown. I believe the play clock expired. Yes, it did. It'll be a delay of game penalty, and that'll set them back 5. And we had a chance to visit with Coach Small and talk to George about the conditioning and how much of a difference they hope it is in terms of a positive this year.
That was one of our target areas as far as getting our football team physically fit. And you know, we give that credit to our strength and conditioning coach. She did a fine job this offseason, and a lot of guys stayed here this summer. We had about 45 guys here this summer just working on those fundamentals.
So basically half the team staying in town as Glenn flushed out of the pocket and passed incomplete. Intended on the far side of the field for number 9, Bud Phillips, who looks like he might have
twisted an ankle,
cramped up, or yeah, maybe twisted an ankle. We'll see. Injury timeout now. They will get Bud over to the sideline, the 6'1 senior
from Greenville, North Carolina. I don't think that's a pin. Again, we heard very evidentially that Coach Hall saw some Leica conditioning last year during the course of the season and made sure he had 45 of his top men there this season and got them well in condition. And as a result, you can see it here today. What a blow.
That was back there over the head of Randall Lankins. That is the second time today that A&T has not been able to negotiate a snap on a field goal attempt. A huge loss that goes all the way into Central Territory. So the Eagles will have the ball in Aggie ground. When we come back to Raleigh, it's 25-0 A&T.
Rush, you are a free CIE course catalog. Call now.
Well, by virtue of a 32-yard loss on the bad snap, North Carolina Central has the ball in Aggie territory for the first time here in the second half. Sean Williams with the flip to Lawrence Fuller. Nothing doing. Great pursuit by that Blue Death defense for A&T.
Fine defensive pursuit that pays off. You said on the flip was flopped. He lost a few yards again. It's been nothing but minus yards for the Eagles of North Carolina Central.
They will stay in the no huddle. Fuller, who had an excellent first half. Remember, he quarterbacked last year, had 1,000-plus yards passing. That was the first time that a Central quarterback had accomplished that since 1998. I'm not sure he likes being a full-time tailback right now, facing that Aggies defense.
Maurice Glenn.
That is Mo Glenn.
Watch this. You remember in the second quarter when A&T's receiver left his feet for this ball, the same ball, and ran into the defensive back? Glenn has got to get off of his feet and stretch out and make that reception. Great throw, bad effort on the reception.
You'll see Williams with the pump fake to the flats, and by that time, they're all over.
Blitz had gotten in and gotten his arm. Good job here. Number 58 thought he had his trio of three for the day.
And now here come the Aggies again. After we've seen Micho Hollingsworth a couple of series, Frank Patterson back into the lineup now with the carry. And a short gain, maybe a yard. We'll call it 2nd and 9.
Herbert Dixon came up with that interception, but guess who was right in the area for it? Joey Lance, waiting for his trilogy of interceptions today.
5 turnovers for Central. 4:10 remaining in the third. Aggies with the ball at their own 42 on 2nd and 9. Out of the shotgun on the option. There's Patterson. It gets stopped. That is excellent pursuit.
Harrison
on the outside. That is Ren Brown, the senior linebacker from Fayetteville, North Carolina.
Jamal Robinson all
also on the stop there defensively, coming up from his left side on the linebacker position. Good job. Here's Frank Patterson, good-looking guy.
Patterson just a sophomore.
Political science major. Well over 100 some yards today, hit for 200 if you can get a pick snap for here.
Out of the shotgun, Glenn wants it. Up in the pocket, he's going to scramble, and he hit a knee right in the line of scrimmage. I'm not sure. I don't think that will be a sack. Looks like his knee hit the ground right at the line of scrimmage at the 41-yard line, so we'll call it no gain.
It brings up a fourth down.
So that will indeed land the fourth down, 11 yards to go.
The punter, who has great acclaims coming into this ball game, has not lived up to his billing.
Yannick Matthews in the kick. Nice spiral. Taken, fumbled at the 27-yard line.
Recovered.
There was a mass scramble for the ball.
I believe the Aggies recovered.
Well, while they sort things out, we are going to go down to the sidelines. NBC Sports Director Charlie Neal is alongside Dr. James Rennick, the Chancellor of North Carolina A&T. Charlie?
Well, thank you so much, Barry. I am with Dr. James Rennick, who is the Chancellor, entering his fifth year as the Chancellor of North Carolina Central, North Carolina A&T University. Sure. You would like to be at North Carolina Central also. You'd like to have both of them, wouldn't you?
No, I'd like it because I'm an Aggie.
I know you.
Pride.
Aggie pride. Let's talk about everybody comes away with a legacy, and I think the legacy that you have brought to the Aggies of North Carolina A&T is the fact that in 3 years, your student enrollment has increased by 3,000 students. You have to feel proud of that.
We're proud of that. We're proud of the long, rich tradition of North Carolina A&T, 113 years old. We've got 10,000 students this year. We continue to educate more African-American engineers and technologists than anyone in the world, and both of these schools are making a difference for our country. And this game, Black College Sports, Black College Football, the bands, the celebration, the pageantry, it's just wonderful.
Let's talk a little bit about the building program you have going on campus, a beautiful campus you have, and you're making it even more beautiful.
We're in the middle stages of a $160 million renovation of the campus and addition of the buildings to the campus so we can maintain our currency and continue to make a difference in our country. And it's just we're transforming the campus physically, and people are working together. Our alums are giving back, and we're very happy.
You've done a great job in the 4 years you've been there, and I know you're looking for many more years, and your team leading right now.
Yeah.
They're pitching a shutout.
Well, we were leading last year too, but we have to stay focused.
I know you do. Dr. James Rennick, let's go back upstairs to Barry.
Charlie, thank you so much. A very proud Chancellor. James C. Rennick right now has seen at least the rest of the Aggie pride, have seen their defensive unit get another stop. Andre Jackson started things off with a huge sack of Sean Williams for an 11-yard loss, and again, the Eagles not able to recover.
No, they're punting now. It's fourth down and plenty, not 20, and plenty. But I'd like to echo the sentiments of Chancellor Rennick about college pageantry. I played in professional football league for 11 years. It was great, but there's nothing like collegiate pageantry. Nothing like collegiate pageantry.
I agree with you 100%, Charlie. We're going to get a penalty right here.
I still love you.
I appreciate it. I was actually looking down on the field, and our director, sports director, Charlie Neal, hardest working guy in sports this weekend, going to get a penalty on North Carolina Central.
We have kick catch interference, 15 yards.
And that is a big one that will carry the ball into Central territory where the Aggies will have it. First and 10. 61 ticks on the clock left here in the third period.
You know, South Carolina Central has given away more yards today than Cornell's giving away tickets this weekend.
I hear you. Our trivia question today for the Aggie Eagle Classic. Each of today's head coaches, Rob Broadway and George Small, played college football in the state of North Carolina. Where did they play?
Got a great gift if you can come up with that answer.
First down, Aggie. the 37 of Central. They pass thrown across the way and complete. And there are a swarm of tacklers over there. All over the receiver, Bud Phillips. Good to see Bud Phillips back on the field. He was injured on one of the final plays of the last offensive series for the Aggies. So Bud Phillips right back out there.
I tell you what, guys cannot afford to stay hurt too long because there's somebody right in their shadow who can feel the bill.
We have seen that on the A&T side big time. And some reserve roles. A lot of the players having very good games. Gain of 3, 2nd and 7. Hand off left side.
Number 28.
That's going to be Carl Scriven.
Yes.
Backup fullback getting some action, although Scriven has played a lot of snaps today. And that will bring us to the end of the third quarter. Well, since our first 15 minutes went by the boards in a nothing-nothing tie, North Carolina A&T has owned this Aggie Classic. It's been a game of turnovers. It's been a game of big plays. It's been Frank Patterson and Michaud Hollingsworth running the ball as well as any Aggie did all last year. Three quarters are in the books from the Aggie Eagle Classic in our score. A&T 25 at Central nothing. We are back at the Aggie Eagle Classic. I want to remind you, September 27th, join NBC Sports at the Willie E. Gary Classic at Alltel Stadium in Jacksonville, Florida. Come early and participate in Dream Big Dreams. That's a fun and motivational experience for youth and adults. After which, T.D. Jakes will deliver a powerful word before the game. The game ticket gets you into all of the day's events. Purchase your tickets through your local Ticketmaster outlet or log on to Ticketmaster.com.
Bishop T.D. Jakes.
Be a very, very fun day in Jacksonville. 34. And the pass knocked away. That is a beautiful defensive play by DeLon Rayner, who came up from his corner spot to break that one up. That will bring up a fourth down play.
This is the kind of cover guys they look for in the National Football League. He was beat, but again, because of his quickness, his fundamentals, his mechanics, he was able to close on the coverage and got there right at the time the ball arrived to bat it down for a pass and complete it.
DeLon Rayner, junior out of Fayetteville. We'll see here what the Aggies decide to do. It looks as if they have the punting team on the field. They're going to try and pin North Carolina Central deep in their own territory. Yannick Matthews had 22 punts inside the 20-yard line last year. Now, this is a guy who knows how to hit that coffin corner.
Indeed, but you know, they may fake the pooch punt and snap it to one of the up backs. They only need about 4 yards for the first and 10, and I don't understand why they're not going for a field goal in this scenario. Pooch punt it is.
Get it high in the air, and this is going to seal into the end zone. Well, how many times have we seen that? He had plenty of time. He probably made the best contact that he's had today.
All day today,
yeah. Our trivia earlier, each of today's head coaches played their college football in the state of North Carolina. We asked, where did they play? Well, George Small, we talked about. He's come back to his alma mater. Rod Broadway played just down the road in Chapel Hill. He was a Tar Heel. In fact, Rod Broadway, an assistant coach at the University of North Carolina, his alma mater, before taking over the reins
of head coach
and directing the program at North Carolina Central.
Yeah, Coach Broadway was right down the street from the Blue Devils in Chapel Hill.
The Central with the ball. After a short game, George Small, of course, has come back from Kentucky to his hometown. And there are some serious fringe benefits about being back at home.
Indeed, there are.
Feels great. Good to be back here in the area, kind of be around your roots, so to speak, and nothing else.
Pass is incomplete.
Well,
that's
Gotta love mom's cooking, don't you?
I think that was the biggest incentive for him coming back, man, to be in mom's kitchen, man. I tell you, there's a lot of great people can cook, but nobody cooks like mom.
George Small, first team All-MEAC for A&T. Played 5 seasons in the National Football League. Giants, Broncos, Packers, Steelers. And I'm going to tell you, you talk about a tough road in your first season. The Aggies don't have a home game until October 18th.
That's a lot of road travel.
I mean, they are on the road. It hadn't fazed them today.
Certainly have. We'll call them Willie Nelson on the road again.
Exactly. They are road warriors today. Just a couple hours out of their home ground in Greensboro. And they have put on a show this afternoon. And they, once again, are going to have outstanding field position. This has just been a game of dominance by this Blue Death defense.
Again, the code, control the line of scrimmage, and control the game. This is
a great kick by Gerald Matkins. Taken on the run by Curtis Deloach once again, and now we're going to get a reverse handoff.
Oh, this could be trouble. This is trouble. This is trouble.
Get a flag. Oh! He reversed his field. Flags flying everywhere.
Probably clip.
At least one clip, yeah, that we saw on the near side of the field. So this one is going to come back. He ran about 112 yards.
Yes, reversing the field. He reversed the field down the left sideline, reversed back down the right sideline. Great field position. I tell you what, this kid has impressed me today, Curtis Deloach. His size, his speed, his agility, and most of all, his ability to cover wide receivers.
This guy also owns the NCAA record for punt returns for a touchdown. Back in 2001, Curtis Deloach,
illegal block,
was an AP All-American.
Return,
there he is, the first reverse.
First down.
He's picking up some valuable blocks here. Good stutter step. Picked up a block from number 4 again. Picked up another block, but again, one illegal block or illegal hold brings it back. Great job. Look at it. He's got that intensity in his eye. Defensive back, kick returner, senior, 6'4", 235. At the top of the telecast, I told you, he's reminiscent to me of that of a Mel Blunt who played for the Pittsburgh Steelers.
5 punt returns for touchdowns back in 2001. Curtis Deloach, as you mentioned, was injured, hurt a knee in this game last year against NC Central. Only had 14 tackles all season. He will have a much bigger year than that.
They never got to him.
The Aggies with the ball again. Scriven on the carry and loses yardage. About a 3-yard loss on the play. Marshall Glenn coming back into the huddle will face a second down and about 13.
I'd like to ask our official statistician, Mr. Herrick, what was the total yardage for our number 21 who's vacated the game, Frank Patterson?
Backs out of the eye.
Front fake.
They want to go deep. Ball's in the air. It's caught, but it's out of bounds. Bud Phillips made a nice catch. Was pressured out of bounds.
Here's Bud Phillips. Good job here. Curl takeoff. Got a hand on him. It should have been interference right there. Run out of real estate. Great throw, great catch. But again, not enough yardage to keep the ball inbound.
Working on DeLon Rayner out there on the corner spot near side of the field. So that'll bring up a 3rd and 13. Just about 12 and a half minutes to go in this Aggie Eagle Classic one that has been controlled since the beginning of the second quarter completely by A&T. Out of the shotgun, Glenn wants to go deep again. He's got Phillips. Oh, and a great play. Great closing speed again. DeLon Rayner. They've been picking on him, and Rayner has answered the call.
Indeed he has. We get a chance to look at it again. 5'10", 185 out of Fayetteville. Good job here. Fine job. Bud Phillips runs a post pattern on him. He gives up 3 yards, but again, three inches in height. But again, great verticality by the defensive back. Good coverage here.
Excellent coverage by the Aggies as Fitz back to receive that one. After after a short gain, it will be Central's football first and 10 from their own 28-yard line, but they trail the Aggies by 25. Oh. 25 to nothing here at the Aggie Eagle Classic. Early in the fourth quarter, hey, investigative, analytical, informative, NBC Network News covers issues and events that impact African-American families. Watch NBC Network News, the new voice, the urban voice for news and information, weeknights at 7, right here on NBC.
Major broadcast cable network at your service.
All right. Eagles football trailing by 25. They have the only time that Central has been in A&T territory in the second half. Remember, it was the bad snap on the field goal attempt. Their offense has done virtually nothing here in the second half.
Movement here. They got 5 yards going back the other way.
Reggie Madeau again jumped the snap count, and that will march them back five.
Repeat first down,
but it'll be first and 15. Rod Broadway obviously knowing that his high-potency offense has a ways to go. But I tell you, you just have to be so impressed with the defensive effort that A&T has brought to the field today. Adrian Warren looking downfield, overshot his receiver, James Hopkins. And that ball's incomplete. It'll be second and 15.
Intended for number 3, Nathaniel Mitch.
Number 26 had a great shot at picking that one off. Wilford Billingsley.
Eddie Ravenel's back up at the strong safety position. Once again, we're seeing a lot of guys get some playing time, and that's great for Alonzo Lee, the defensive coordinator, and George Small, getting guys some quality minutes, meaningful minutes.
Most assured
in a meaningful game.
Wholesale substitution.
Warren again looking over the middle. This time it's complete. That ball is caught by Torian Hinton. Yeah. 6 foot senior, the first catch of the day for Hinton.
Right at home. He's a hometown grown young man. You get a chance to see it again. He runs a curl pattern. Good job by Warren getting outside the tackle, throwing the curl to Torian Hinton, senior wide receiver from Durham.
Deron Thomas with the tackle on the play. Third down, 3. Big conversion here. Warren on the run. Gets a block. Gets across the 40. Picks up the first down yardage out to the 43-yard line. First and 10, Central. That's a huge play.
Big play as well. It looked like they tried to undress him as he approached the first would-be tackler, gets a clean block, and trips out of bounds, and it looked like they tried to take his jersey off.
So after the stop by Charles Barham, it'll be first down Central, one of only 8 for the Eagles on the day.
Big disparity.
Twice that number for A&T. Little flare pass out into the flats. That is caught by Nathaniel Finch, and he gets it just across the 50-yard line and into Aggie territory. They'll spot it at the 49-yard line of A&T. So, indeed, this is the first time that the Eagles have earned their way into A&T territory here in the second half.
Yes, good job, good throw-catch combination. Second down and about 3.
7 yards on the completion. Warren, back to pass again. Gets
it up. Pick it up.
He's coming to the near sideline across the 40, down to the 42. It'll be another first down for Central.
Stephen Rogers comes up with that stop number 37 from his defensive back position from Culpeper, Virginia.
There's Jerome Myers, our student athlete of the game for A&T. A 3.8 grade point average in civil engineering. Jerome Myers, a 6'1 sophomore out of Pine Forest High School in Fayetteville, North Carolina. Once again, let's go back down to the sidelines where sports director Charlie Neal is with Chancellor James Ammons. Charlie.
Thank you very much, Barry. I am with Dr. James Ammons, the Chancellor.
of North Carolina Central University. Deja vu. Last year this time you were down 27-0. You came back and won the game in overtime. You think you can do it again? Can you take two heart attacks in a row?
Well, I tell you what, if these guys play with the same heart that they did last year, it's possible.
All right. Well, let's talk a little bit about North Carolina Central. I understand you just received a $19 million grant. Talk a little bit about it and how it's going to benefit the university.
Well, the state of North Carolina is one of the leading states in the area of biomanufacturing and biotechnology. And the Golden Leaf Foundation, which was set up to administer the tobacco settlement, granted North Carolina Central University $19.1 million to start undergraduate and graduate programs in biomanufacturing and bioprocessing.
So you're doing a great job. You're getting, knocking on some doors, and some doors are being opened for you. That's very important.
Well, they are. One of the things that they saw is that this biotechnology industry employs somewhere in the neighborhood of 18,500 people, and only about 2% of those are African Americans working in the laboratories and in the scientific part of it. And North Carolina Central University is going to create a pool for them to recruit from.
Sounds like great things happening down in Durham at North Carolina Central University. We wish you the best of luck, and thank you for spending some time with us, Dr. James Ammons, who is the chancellor of North Carolina Central University. Now let's go back upstairs to Barry and Lynn.
Charlie, thanks so much. We just saw North Carolina Central with the pass completion, but a loss of a couple of yards. And here we see a little bit of the flavor of the game, the A&T sidelines. These are the golden delights. The dancing portion of that blue and gold marching machine. Reviews from host Corey Sue Miller wraps up the summer with the season's biggest hits and misses. Plus, they'll give you a preview of the fall's best movie picks. That's Real Reviews with your host Corey Sue Miller on Thursday, September 18th. Where else but NBC?
Absolutely.
Future Aggies and Eagles.
That's right, and we are at the Aggie Eagle Classic at Carter-Finley Stadium in Raleigh, North Carolina, with Lem Barney and Carlos McCormick. I'm Barry Milligan, and Charlie Neal, our sports director, pulling double duty this weekend as well. Great to have Charlie here with us at the Classic.
Good to see Chaz again.
Absolutely.
Heat
big time, and the heat is on, but Adrian Warren able to make some positive yardage anyway. Flushed out of the pocket back there. Herbert Dixon flushed him out. Finally, he's dropped by Doug Okoracha, that 6'2 senior Aggie defensive end, they call him, the Aggie end and the Fox end in Alonzo Lee's defensive scheme. Picks up about 5 on the play, limb. 3rd down and 6. They have converted 2 straight 3rd downs. Let's see if Warren can do it here. In the pocket. Pass over the middle. Oh, it's underthrown. He had Nathaniel Fitz wide open.
Yeah, that was like skipping stones on the riverbank. He popped it off the grass.
Short arm that one. Might have gotten a little excited when he saw him so
wide open. Yeah, may have been tipped just
that
a bit.
Fluttered a bit, yeah.
May have been tipped right there at the line of scrimmage. Good job. I tell you what, this young man has played his heart out today. Adrian Warren, number one, sophomore quarterback, 6'5", 208, Raleigh, North Carolina.
Well, the Aggies only had 10 men on the field. Coming out there, Jermaine Brantley a little bit late, getting out onto the defensive line on the kickoff coverage. So the Aggies will take a timeout with 8:17 to go, and we will take the timeout as well. It has been all A&T since the end of the first quarter. The Aggies lead it 25-0.
And securing our future.
MEAC's
scores for you. Alabama State beats Florida A&M 38-22. Virginia State beats Norfolk State 16-15. Bethune-Cookman trounces Savannah State 62-12. Morgan State 19-16 over Towson State. And South Carolina State loses to Tennessee State 37-20. Now back to Raleigh.
North Carolina Central 25-0. And Central not able to get anything going offensively here in the second half. That punt high in the air takes a Central bounce. Did they down it on the field of play? No, it hit the end line. They thought they had gotten it down. They did not. The ball touched the end line. Ruled a touchback. Come out to the 20-yard line. The Aggies will have the ball, and they also have a commanding lead when we come back to Raleigh. Our sports director here at NBC, Charlie Neal. Great to have Charlie along as North Carolina A&T has completely dominated North Carolina Central here this afternoon, looking to avenge last year's 33-30 overtime loss.
Yeah, it's not going to happen today, however. 7 minutes, 38 seconds remaining. Aggies over the Eagles, 25-0.
Well, as Charlie was down there with the NCC Chancellor James Ammons, I think all the high hopes in the world can help the Eagles right now because they have just been completely outplayed.
Dominated on both sides of the line of scrimmage.
Well, better days are ahead, no doubt, for Rod Broadway. His team, obviously, will still, I think, be a factor in this CIAA race. They will take on the powerhouse from the SIAC, Morehouse, in week two. They'll play Delaware State in week three. But still, it's going to be a rough road, and it always is when you're trying to establish a brand new system. Collinsworth with the pitch, far side of the field. He is tracked down and dropped by Jamar Neely, the backup defensive end, 6'2", 235-pound sophomore, getting some playing time out there on that Central defensive unit.
Despite the lopsidedness of the ball game, the defense has continued to play ball. Neely, great pursuit. Again, good linebacker play. They have not given up. They've given out, but they haven't given up. They've given out a talent for the day.
Yannick Matthews stands at his 5-yard line, set to punt this one away. High hanging kick that will bounce and actually take a Central bounce and be downed in Aggie territory. So the Eagles will have the ball at the 48-yard line, first and 10. See Ron Broadway pacing the sidelines, had a 24-year assistant coaching career at North Carolina, University of Florida, and Duke University before taking over the helm here. And at quarterback, Adrian Mora. There you see your yards per play this afternoon, and that certainly reflects on the difficult time the Eagles have had as they still try and spread the field here as we talk to Rod Broadway about the four receiver set and some of the things he has learned from his former head coach.
Genius, I think, offensively. And if we can be half as successful as he was with what he was doing, with what we're doing, then I think we have a great offense here. I know we can't do what he did. You know, we got to be North Carolina Central. We got to create something before I tell them up here. But I do believe this, you know, playing wide open, spreading the field, getting the balls in the hands of the league, is the best chance I think we're going to have to win.
Well, it may be too little, too late, but the Eagles certainly haven't given up. Adrian Warren just delivered a beautiful pass over the defense into the seam there and hit Nathaniel Fitch for a big first down, 26 yards on the reception.
Two big pitches and catches by quarterback Adrian Warren again, both resulting in first down. It's about first and 10 now at the 12-yard line.
Warren on the option coming near side. Oh, boy, nothing doing there.
Bad decision, I would say.
Herbert Dixon shot the gap there from his Mike linebacker spot. Stopped that play, Cole.
We've called Brother Dixon number 33, his number almost all day from the opening bell.
And he's another one of these underclassmen, just a sophomore. You see the numbers on Adrian Warren, 13 for 24, but three big picks, two of those to Joey Lance, and the other to Maurice Weaver. Loss of a couple long plays, second and 12, pass over the middle, caught, but again, there is Herbert Dixon, who is all over Nathaniel Fitch, the receiver on the play.
And Ravenel also, number 23.
Eddie Ravenel, exactly.
Eddie Ravenel coming up from his safety position there and putting a pop on him.
Now he's a senior who just did it all at his strong safety spot last year for the Aggies. 54 tackles, 13 tackles for loss. 39 after the short game. Warren rolling right. And throws it just short, incomplete, but that's about the only place he could try and deliver that ball, trying to find Brian Debnam over at the far pylon, but short hopped it. That'll bring up fourth down. Now, no reason to go for three here. I mean, obviously, with 4:52 to go in the game.
It would look better than zero, I tell you that.
They're going for the end zone. They can get
a first down,
here. Yeah. 9 yards would get them down to the two and a first down as Warren takes a snap out of the shotgun, rolls to his right, turns, fires. That ball is tipped and incomplete.
What a close.
That is a great defensive play over there by Curtis Deloach.
Yes, sir. I'm going to see it. I'm going to see it. I'm going to tell the people about it, too. Watch him from his position. He backs up. Good close. Look at this. Boom. Without ever touching the receiver, great job. Professional prospect, no doubt about it.
Excellent burst of speed there as James Hopkins just kind of, when he made the turn, stood his ground. If he comes back for that, maybe he has a chance to make that reception. But anyway, tremendous play by Curtis Close. Breaks up another pass. So
senior defensive back from Mercer, North Carolina.
Aggies take it over on down. Joe Hollingsworth with the handoff. And right now, obviously for the Aggies, the clock is your friend.
Absolutely.
A&T in full command of this Aggie Eagle Classic.
You know, one thing about this game that Coach Barkley can take back and reassess and look at is his game system that he brought into this new season to see what he needs to fine-tune, see what he needs to tweak, and then go from there.
Well, I'm going to tell you something, Lynn. I don't want to get crazy here and put too much pressure on George Small and the Aggies, but they were picked sixth this year in the MEAC preseason standings. The last time the Aggies were picked sixth was back in 99. They went 8-0 in the league and won the Black College National Championship.
Well, that's no question.
I tell you, this is not a team that looks like it's the sixth best in the MEAC.
Not today. They look very good today. Again, firing on all cylinders. Special teams, offense and defense. Again, control both lines of scrimmage, offense and defenses. Again, he came in with a good program, the off-season training program, the weight training program, worked their principles, mechanics, and fundamentals. He's brought a sense of urgency to this North Carolina A&T team.
I tell you, just again, you can't say enough about the conditioning of this team. They have done a tremendous job. As coming near sideline, Frank Patterson. Hey, his day isn't over yet.
What's up with Frank being back
in the game? He's got 169 and looking for more.
Look, you're holding his right wrist, too. I told you, something had to be hurt on it in the early going of the second quarter. I thought he was off eating hot dogs or something. I haven't seen him so long.
I'm telling you.
Bring me one with chili on it, Frankie.
They just Gonzalez taped him up and sent him back on the field. The gain, though, not enough for a first down, so fourth down punting situation here for the Aggies. Yannick Matthews, inside his own 10-yard line, gets this one away. Fields it just inside his own territory by Nathaniel Fitch. So the Eagles will have the ball first and 10 at the Aggies 46-yard line. But before we get back to the action, let's get to the sidelines and check in on Carlos McCormick.
Hey, what's going on up there? The Aggies are strong-arming the Eagles today, and a big reason why is because their strength and conditioning coach, Christine Alonji. How impressed are you of your guys today?
Oh, very impressed. They stepped it up. They worked hard all summer, and it's showing today on the field.
Talk a little bit about a female in your profession. How'd you get the respect of these guys?
I came in with the same goal. The first day of conditioning last summer, Coach A, you're trying to kill us. I said, no, guys, I'm just trying to win a championship. From then on, it's been nothing but hard work.
So talk a little bit about your background. How did you get into this?
Former powerlifter. Competed on the national level, powerlifting and Olympic lifting. And it just went from there. Studied it in college, got my degrees. From there.
Thanks a lot, Christine. Barry, she already gave me the word she's going to turn my 12-pack into a 6-pack. Back to you guys.
Carlos, right. It could never happen, brother. Yes, it could. Keep hope alive, Carlos.
In that case, I think we need to work on my case.
I love you too, Barry.
I also think we probably ought to call Coach Small. I think she needs a raise. I think Christine needs a raise from what we've seen this afternoon.
About the results of what Christine has done again during this offseason with the ball players, and again, she too brought a sense of urgency in getting these guys in great condition, the weightlifting program, and it certainly has showed in this early season opener in this Aggie Eagle Classic.
Now Warren will operate from under center here.
Reverse
on
pass.
Play reverse, and it will be a pass across the field and almost picked off. That is Sean Williams, the backup quarterback.
Should have been a penalty, I thought. It was
and there is a flag on the far side.
Yeah, it was some interference, I thought, on the quarterback who would be the intended receiver, Adrian Warren. Let's see what the officials say. See if we're on the same page.
Ineligible man downfield.
I'm sorry, we're not on the same page.
Defensive holding on the defense.
All right, we're on the same set. All right, we're on the same page. I know I didn't see the holding, but I saw the interference.
So, offsetting penalties gives the Eagles another chance here at the Aggies 46-yard line. Third down and 10, just over 2 minutes to play.
For a little while, I was about to say I was in the wrong book. The same page.
This time, Warren lines up in the shotgun. Four receiver set once again, and he's going deep.
Pick off.
Deep over the middle, and it is kicked off by Deron Thomas. The sophomore quarterback comes up with another Aggies turnover, the sixth of the day. We will revisit another big defensive play when we come back to Raleigh, where the Aggies have this Aggie Eagle Classic well in hand. North Carolina A&T will win this Aggie Eagle Classic. The Aggies lead it 25-0, and it's just too hard to pick out one guy. The Eagle defense, or the Blue Death defense, is the MVP of the game, Lombardi, the whole group.
That's a very good assessment. Or we could have given it to the offensive player, who was Frank Patterson. But again, I think the defense set the tone today for the offense. The defensive line controlled the line of scrimmage there against the offense of North Carolina Central. But again, making great plays like this. Joey Lance, two big interceptions, defensive sacks on the quarterback, great stops here, the safety, and I tell you, just a great all-around play, great effort by the defense. Defense deserves the four sacks, six turnovers. I mean, just a tremendous day defensively for this Aggie team of North Carolina A&T.
Well, hats off to Alonzo Lee, the defensive coordinator, and obviously George Small said he wants to reestablish the type of defense that he had at Kentucky State that led the nation. He's done it. If this is any indication, he has certainly done it. There is Coach Smalls. Aggies will begin their season 1-0. And again, we talked about them. They're going to have to continue to be Road Warriors. They won't play at home in Aggie Stadium until a big matchup with Florida A&M on October 18th. I guarantee it. With Sam leaving the MEAC, Billy Joe's team's going to have a big target on it every week this season.
Certainly is. Okay, they'll have five more road games before they play their first home game.
Minute 15, and the clock is running. Backs in the eye now. This is obviously academic at this point, as the Aggies will hand it off and let that clock run. Now we're going to get some flags that will stop the clock.
A lot of dirty laundry on the field.
Yeah, you don't want to see things get a little chippy. Obviously, these two clubs are big rivals. We talked about that all afternoon, but you don't want to see things get a little out of hand here in the waning moments. So foul penalty will be called against North Carolina Central.
That might be an ejection, huh?
I tell you another thing you have to be impressed with. Remember, all the way back in the first quarter, all the penalties that the Aggies have had, they have played virtually mistake-free football since.
Certainly have.
Now for our NBC long distance play of the game, and this one will be a memorable play indeed, not only for Marshall Glenn but for Eric Arnett, the senior from Raleigh. His first career reception for a touchdown, and it comes in the Aggie Eagle Classic. Congratulations, Glenn, to Arnett, our NBC long distance play of the game. 53-51 now, and the clock is rolling. The ball moved up to the 27-yard line, where the Aggies just now going to hand it off. Run this one out. Michel Hollingsworth takes the handoff, and he is dropped at the line of scrimmage. We'll see when they spot the ball. They will let the clock run under the play clock time before they spot the ball. Smart move. No need. Another play, certainly not necessary at this juncture.
Unless they just want to stick the dagger right through the heart,
yeah.
You know, which I pray that they won't. I'm sure the coach is getting that. Do not run a play for the true spirit of sports.
Well, this one is history. The 44th win in the series for North Carolina A&T, and it comes in very impressive fashion, 25-0. And I tell you what, an historic day for North Carolina A&T, Lynn Barney. They started playing football back in 1924. This is win number 400 for North Carolina A&T in the history of that program. And again, it comes in very impressive fashion.
Indeed, just a tremendous game plan today for the offense and the defense. They shut out the Eagles offense 25-0, and we're now down on the sideline with Carlos.
With just one of the heroes of the day, linebacker Joey Lance.
That's right. He had a very big game today. Number 58 for the Aggies, Joey Lance. Talk a little bit about the team performance, first of all.
Hey, it's all about team right now. We came in as one heartbeat. We left out one heartbeat. We swung to the ball all day, and we ended up with it. Got a goose head on 25-9, so it's all about team.
Talk a little bit about the motto this week was the big payback.
Big payback. We gave up 31 points last year, or 30-some points last year, and we had it down deep in our soul. And it's been 365 days to the day, and got our payback.
How does it feel to have a touchdown in this classic? Talk a little bit about it.
Hey, my first touchdown ever in the classic, my last one, so it's good, bro. Good note.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot. Congratulations. He's a grad student at North Carolina A&T. Back up to you guys.
Well, one thing I'd like to say, Carlos, is that Joey Lance talked about James Brown with the big payback. And I guess it was sweet revenge, two interceptions, one picked off for a touchdown, his last classic. It's going to be memorable for years to come.
Well, that grad student in graphic design couldn't have drawn a better picture than he and his Aggies put forth on the field today at Carter-Finley Stadium. The Aggie Eagle Classic is history, and it's won by the Aggies 25-0.
Hi, I'm Kim Fields, and you're watching NBC, your family's urban network.
North Carolina A&T wanted to control the offensive line. They did it one better, Limbarney. They controlled the offensive and defensive line. Seventh in the MEAC in rushing last year. Today, the Aggies earned the trophy as the Aggie Eagle Classic champion. 207 rushing yards.
That's just tremendous offense, regardless of who's running that ball. And again, I made the code about the National Football League. It filters down through college, high school, junior high, as well as Pee Wee ball. When you control the line of scrimmage, you control football. And again, both lines were controlled by the offense and the defense of that Aggie extended defense and an aggressive offense.
Let's take a look at our NBC drive of the game, and the guy who was steering that locomotive, Frank Patterson, just a sophomore, but this young man played much more mature than those years this afternoon.
I tell you what, he's got some nifty feet, he's got great vision, and I tell you, he keep working like this. You can see an NFL number on his back in a couple of years. Here's the touchdown. After running about a 40-yard run, I thought he was tired with all the moves that he had made, and he gallops into the end zone for 21 more yards. What a terrific day by that young man, Frank Patterson.
23 carries, 175 yards, and the touchdown for Frank Patterson, a day that he will remember for an awfully long time, as well his Aggies teammates who have avenged that 33-30 overtime loss to Central a year ago by getting the whitewash today, beating North Carolina Central 25-0. And really, this is exactly what George Small and all the Aggies wanted in terms of trying to turn around that losing season, get some enthusiasm back into the program, and get them off to a great start.
Well, again, I talked about the sense of urgency that coach had coming into this year. He's coming back home, came in for the 10th Classic. Again, he felt that his ball players were ready. He got them ready during the offseason with the weight training program. He got their minds trained, their bodies was trained, and their spirit showed today that they were actually ready for this season.
All right, NBC would like to thank North Carolina A&T President Dr. James C. Rennick, Athletic Director Charles Davis, Coach George Small and his staff, Sports Information Director Jim McNally and his staff for all their help in bringing us the 10th anniversary of the Aggie Eagle Classic. Also, big thanks go out to North Carolina Central University Chancellor Dr. James Ammons, Athletic Director Bill Hayes, Coach Rod Broadway and his staff, including Sports Information Director Kyle Serva, and all of his support people as well, for their help in bringing us the 10th anniversary of the Aggie Eagle Classic. Big thanks go out to my partner, Lim Barney, also Carlos McCormick, and our NBC Sports Director, Charlie Neal, for being here this afternoon. Our final score today, Aggies 25, Eagles nothing. Coming up next Saturday, another doubleheader. It'll be Tuskegee and Benedict at 4, followed by Grambling and Alcorn State at 8. Coming up at 8 p.m. tonight, it's Tuskegee versus Miles, live from Birmingham. This has been a special presentation of NBC Sports. We're not just playing games, we're making history. And from all of us at NBC, this is Barry Milligan saying so long from Raleigh, North Carolina, and congratulations once again to the Aggies of North Carolina A&T, winners in the 10th anniversary edition of the Aggie Eagle Classic in fine fashion. It's the Aggies 25, the Eagles nothing. So long, everybody.